सदा शिव समारंभां शंकराचार्य मध्यमां अस्मदाचार्य पर्यन्तां वंदे गुरु परंपरां भारती करुणापात्रं भारती पदभूषणं भारती पदमारूढं भारती तीर्थमाश्रये विद्या विनय संपन्नं वीतरागं विवेकिनं वंदे वेदांत तत्वज्ञं विधुशेखर भारती। सद्गुरु चरणारविंदाभ्यां नमः। I welcome all of you to, on behalf of Tattvaloka and Sringeri Gurubandhava, to this lecture series on Srimad Appaya Dikshitendra to commemorate his 500th Jayanti. Sri Appaya Dikshitendra lived during the 16th century. He was a prolific writer and a literary genius with over 104 works credited to him. He was an Advaitin and he wrote many works on Advaita, but his book Siddhantalesha Sangraha and Parimala Vyakhya is a must-learn book for all students of Advaita who venture into learning Brahma Sutra Bhashya. He was also proficient in other matas, as his Chaturmata Sara Sangraha indicates. His Ishta Devata was Shiva, but he could also write, he was equally devoted to Vishnu, and he wrote charming and exquisite poem Varadarajastava and Harihara Abheda Stuti. He was proficient in every branch of learning and he has contributed by writing on Mimamsa, Vyakarana, Nyaya, Sahitya and Vedanta. And we have numerous compositions on stotras for and devotional hymns for the for us to recite every day. His Durga Chandrakala Stuti is supposed to be a mantra stotra, which is recited every day by, which is Sara of Devi Mahatmyam and recited by everyone. It is fitting that we are going to learn more about Sri Dikshitendra and Sri Dr. M. Gokulakrishnayyar will be enlightening us with his 3-day talk series. Dr. Gokulakrishnayyar is an Ayurvedic practitioner. He has pursued Sahitya study along with his Ayurveda studies. And he has passionately pursued study of Dikshitendra's works. He is well known in Vedantic circles, an Astikya and Vaidika Marga follower. Sri Gokulakrishnayyar will be joining us from Shringeri Srirangammat and from Sakshat Ambal Sannadhi, Sharada Ambal and Acharyal Sannadhi. And we are blessed in that way and we welcome him to take over this evening's talk. There may be a few interruptions as the bandwidth is low in Srirangammat, but I think it'll we'll be patient and it will get sorted out. I now welcome Dr. Gokulakrishnayyar.
Yes, Gokulakrishnayyar.
Yeah.
Please go ahead.
My humble obeisances to Sri Sharada Amba, to Sri Adi Shankara Bhagavatpada, and Sri Mad Appaya Dikshitendra. My humble obeisances to the Jagadguru Shankaracharyas of Sringeri, Sri Bharati Tirtha Mahaswamigal, and Jagadguru Shankaracharya Sri Vidhushekara Bharati Swamigal. I thank Sri Sringeri Guru Bandhava team and Sri Tattvaloka team for organizing this event. I thank the administrators of Sri Shankara Gurukulam of Srirangam for hosting the event in the temple's premises here. Today is the 500th Jayanti of Srimad Appaya Dikshitendra. It is a well-known fact that Advaita Siddhantam is the ultimate purport of all the Vedic literatures, the Vedas, the Itihasa Puranas, the Brahma Sutras, Upanishads, and the Bhagavad Gita. So with the passage of time in Kali Yuga, when religions like Buddhism and Jainism started rising, so there was a big threat to the path of pure Sanatana Dharma. There is a threat to Sri Varnashrama Dharma in Kali Yuga. And it was at that time that Bhagavan appeared himself in the earthly planet, in the village known as Kaladi, as the son of Sri Shivaguru Dikshitar and Sri Aryamba. He took the form of a Paramahamsa Parivrajakacharya or a sannyasi and resurrected the Shrauta Marga. He lived for 32 years, and after he left for the Kaivalya Samrajyam, once again Adharma started rising in the society. So over time, there was a lot of Shivadvesham in Tamil, in the places like Tamil Nadu and others. So there was a threat to the Shiva Bhajana Satpatha. So it was at that time, God had to appear once again in the form of a Yayajuka Brahmana or as a Grihastha Agnihotra Hotri Brahmana, and he was known as Srimad Appaya Dikshitendra in this avatara. He took birth in a place known as Adayapalam, which is located near the Kshetram of Tiruvirinchipuram, close to Kanchipuram. So he was born as the son of Sri Rangaraja Advarya, Rangaraja Dikshitar. And Dikshitendra was such a personality that as a meticulous practitioner of the Shrauta Karmas, he set an example to the Brahmanas to practice Shrautam in the prescribed way. As a scholar of the Shastras, he produced a Veni Magna opera in every corner of his variegated vineyards of the different Shastras, in Alankara Shastram, in Vyakarana Shastram, in Purva Mimamsa Shastram, and in four schools of the Vedanta Shastram. Advaita Vedantam of Adishankara Bhagavatpada, Shivadvaitam of Shrikantha Shivacharya, Vishishta Advaitam of Shri Ramanujacharya, and Dvaita Vedantam of Shri Madhvacharya. As an exemplary Bhagavad Bhakta, he was greatly devoted to Lord Shiva, and he has produced innumerable Stotra Granthas that are a source of treasure and solace to the Bhakta. So we all have heard about the Ekashloki Shankara Stuti. Shri Bhashya Swamigal of Mahadanapuram had condensed the entire Shankara Vijayam into one single shloka. Aryamba Jathare Janir Dvijasati Daridriya Nirmulam. So all of us have heard of that shloka. In the same way, there was a disciple of Jagadguru Shankaracharya, Shri Sachidananda Shivabhinam and Drisimha Bharati Swamigal. He was living in Shri Shankara Gurukulam of Srirangam for quite some time during his last years. He has condensed the whole of Srimad Appaya Dikshitendra's Vijayam into one single Gadhyam. Gadhyam means prose. And incidentally, so the names of both the Bhashya Swamigal and the name of this Swamigal are one and the same, Shri Sachidananda Tirtha Swamigal. So both the Sachidananda Tirtha Swamigals have condensed the charitams of both the great Mahatmas into one single verse. So this is how the verse goes on. तदानीं खल्वि मे महापुरुषाः निबन्धुश्चतुरधिकशतं निबन्धजातं प्राचीचरन्नाचार्य भाष्यं आसेतुतु हिनाचलं निरवैवृतं निष्प्रयासलेशं नानाविधानध्वरविशेषान् तादीदृशं शिवभक्तेः अपरिमाणं गरिमाणं अजुघूषन् परमेश्वरस्य अतनिमानं महिमानं अन्वभूवन्नासेतुतु हिनाचलं सर्वतो बहुमानं अनीनयन वर्षपूगम द्वासप्तति परिमाण यलीयंत चांते चिरंतरायमंत कांत पदपाथोजयोः इत्यादि दीक्षितेंद्र चरित्रम सुप्रसिद्धमेव. दिस इज द गद्य, दिस इज द मीनिंग ऑफ इट. तदानीं खल्वि मे महापुरुषाः, इट वाज एट दैट टाइम दिस ग्रेट पर्सनालिटी निबन्धुश्चतुरधिकशतम निबन्ध जातम कंपोज्ड 104 वर्क्स प्राचीचरन आचार्य भाष्यम. Tachicharan means he propagated That is the study of Acharya Bhashyam, the Brahma Sutra Bhashyam of Sri Adi Shankara Bhagavatpada, Asetu to Hinachalam, from the shores of Rameshwaram to the Himalayas. Niravivritan Nishprayasa Lesham Nana Vidhan Adhvara Visheshan. He performed without any difficulties. He performed with great ease. The innumerable sacrifices enjoined in the Shruti. Nishprayasa Lesham Nana Vidhan Adhvara Visheshan. Adhvara means Yajnam. And then Pradidrishan. He showed Pradidrishan Shiva Bhaktehe Aparimanam Garimanam. He showed the importance of Shiva Bhakti to people. And then Ajughushan, he proclaimed very loudly, Ajughushan Parameshwarasya Atanimanam means something that is great. Anything that is powerful. Mahimanam is greatness. So the greatness of Lord Shiva. And then Anbabhuvan Asetu Himachalam Sarvato Bahumanam, he commanded great respect from Rameshwaram in the south to the Himalayas in the north, Tarbato Bahumanam. And then Aninayan Varshapugam Dvasaptati Parimanam. He lived a lifespan of 72 long years. And at the end, Yaliyanta, he merged with the deity of Lord Natarajar in Chidambaram. So this is the Dikshitendri Vijayam in one single Gadhyam. When the Lord created this universe, as Sri Adi Shankara Bhagavatpada says in his Bhagavad Gita Bhashyam, for the sake of its sustenance, he created a twofold dharma. One is Pravritti Dharma and the other one is Nivritti Dharma. Pravritti Dharma is where the practitioners engage in different kinds of worldly life and then seek moksha. In Nivritti Dharma, a person gives up the worldly life completely and then seeks the path of moksha. To establish Pravritti Dharma, he created sages like Marichi and others. To establish Nivritti Dharma, he created sages like Sanaka Sanatana Sanandanas. So whenever there is a decline in Dharma, the Lord appears himself. And the Lord says in the Bhagavad Gita, in the third chapter of Bhagavad Gita, that he has created two kinds of Nishtha. Lokesmin Vividha Nishtha Purapropta Mayanagha Jnana Yogena Sankhyanam Karma Yogena Yoginam. Here is the Anvayam for the Shloka. Hey Anagha, O sinless Arjuna, Asmin Loke, in this world, Jnana Yogena Sankhyanam Karma Yogena Yoginam Iti Vividha Nishtha Maya Proktapura. So there is a very beautiful commentary on this written by Swami Shankarananda Saraswati. So just like we have got the Madhusudana Saraswati's commentary in on Bhagavad Gita, Sridhara Swami's commentary on Bhagavad Gita. So there is a wonderful commentary written by Swami Shankarananda Saraswati. And it is interesting to note that in Panchadashi, Swami Vidyaranyar makes a reference to Swami Shankarananda Saraswati in the Guru and the Adya Shloka. And this is how the Vyakhyanam goes on. Hey Anagha, O sinless Arjuna, Lokesmin. So the word Lokesmin is explained as Brahmanadinam Mumukshuparan Swadharma Nishthanam Mumukshunam. So of the Brahmanas and others who seek moksha and who adhere to the Anushthanam of Swadharma, Swadharma Paranam Mumukshunam Loke, Pura, once upon a time, Purvasmin Kale, Maya Veda Rupina, Sarvajnena, Swadharmopadeshra. As the all-knowing person, as the Bhagavan who instructs in one Swadharma, Vividha means of two types, Viprakara, Nishtha means Dharmaha or Vyavastha. So here he explains it as, Shastriyasya Anushteyasya Dharmasya Asankaryayatha Tatha Niyamena Sthitir Vyavastha, he says. Shastriyasya, of that which is enjoined in the Shastras, Anushteyasya, of that which has to be observed, Dharmasya Asankarya means without confusing or without mixing two things together. Asankarya yatha tatha niyamena. So with all niyamas, niyamena sthitir prokta. And then he says, tat kathamiti ched uchyate. How do you explain it? In Ketaka, he says, jnana dara. So there are two padams in the shloka. Jnana yogena sankhyanam, karma yogena yogina. So let us see the explanation for the padam jnana yogena sankhyana. Vedantaihi khyapyate samyak pratipadyate tatparyena pratipadyate iti sankhyam nirvisesham param brahma. Vedantaihi, by the Vedanta Vakyas, it could be by the Upanishads or by the Vedanta Sutra, the Brahma Sutra, Vedanta Vakya, Vedantaihi, samyaka, in a perfect khyapyate, anything that is made known, tatparyena pratipadyate, anything that is explained in detail with illustrations, pratipadyate iti sankhyam. So sankhyam is nirvishesham param brahma, the supreme impersonal brahman. Tadeva svatmatvena ye viduhu te sankhyaha. Those who realize that supreme being as one's own self, they are known as sankhyaha or brahmavidaha. Tesham sankhyanam means yatinam brahmavidam. So the word yati is being used by Sri Shankarananda Saraswati Swami here. So it denotes sannyasis. So the word sankhya here denotes sannyasis here. And then once again he says, jnana yogena brahmavita brahmana yujyate ekikriyate anena iti yogaha. So through the jnana yoga, the knower of Brahman gets merged with the Brahman itself. So because this acts as an instrument, it is known as yoga. Jnana meva yoga, jnana yoga. Tena, again he says, tena means through this jnana yoga, sarvamidam aham cha brahmaiva iti brahmakara vritya. Naishchalyena sthitihi vyavasthitam. Then he says, sarvamidam aham cha, so the whole of this, the external universe that is being seen, aham cha, so my own self and the whole of this universe is nothing but an extension of that Brahman. So in this way, brahmakara vritya nishtha, so this kind of a nishtha, so this is sadaika vritya kartavyetvena vihita for sannyasis. So at all times, sannyasis are expected to meditate upon the impersonal Brahman. Sadaika ritya kartavyatvena vihita. And then, tamevaikam vijanatha, atmanam anyavacho vimunchatha, omityevam dhyayatha, vedanta vijnana sunishchitarthaha, sarvam khalvidam brahma, tameva dhiro vijnaya prajnankurdita brahmanah, nanudhyaya bahun shabdana, वाचो विग्लापनम हितत इत्यादि वाक्यैः अतत् प्रवृत्तिं निषिध्य यति. सो ही सेज दैट थ्रू ऑल ऑफ दीस वेदांत वाक्यास, सो सन्यासीज आर एक्सपेक्टेड टू फॉरगेट ऑल वर्ल्डली पर्सूट एंड मेडिटेट ओनली अपॉन द सुप्रीम इंपर्सनल ब्रह्म. एंड देन ही एक्सप्लेन्स द वर्ड कर्मयोगेन योगिनाम. सो योगिना मीन्स गृहिणाम, गृहिणा मीन्स गृहस्थानम. एंड फॉर गृहस्थास Shrautasmartha karma nishtha. So this is told for grihasthas. Again, we have got vakyams like Aharaha sandhyam upasita, udite surye pratar juhoti, vasante brahmano gninadadhita, urbanne veha karmani, jijivishe chatam samaha. And then, ritam cha svadhyaya pravachanecha, satyam cha svadhyaya pravachanecha, agnayas cha svadhyaya pravachanecha, agnihotram cha svadhyaya pravachanecha, satyam vada dharmam chara tanitvayo pasyani. So through all of these vakyams for grihasthas, that is the yogi, the word the yogi here means grihastha. So for the yogis here, shrautasmartha karmanishtha has been told. Evam karminam grihasthanam akarminam sanyasinam cha. Again he says nishtha dvayam asankirnam. So the two kinds of nishthas has been explained for grihasthas who are expected to do karmas, and sannyasis who are expected to give up all Vaidika karmas. And then that means vibhajya pradarshita mityartha, he says. So it is to show us these two Vaidika nishthas by example that Bhagavan took avataram in Kali Yuga. Again, we all know that mauna vyakhya prakatita parabrahma tattvam yuvanam. So in Kali Yuga, Lord Dakshinamurti gave up his maunam and took avataram once as a sannyasi. And he wrote commentaries on the Brahma Sutras, on Upanishads, and on the Bhagavad Gita. In another avataram, he appeared himself as a grihastha brahmana, as Srimad Appayya Dikshitendra, and instructed us on pravritti nishtha. And once Once again, Sri Sachidananda Tirtha Swamigal explains the two kinds of nishthas observed by Sri Adi Shankara Bhagavatpada and Srimad Appaya Dikshitendra very beautifully. So on 5th of October in 1941, Dikshitendra Jayanti was observed here in Srirangam during the time of Sri T.K. Balasubramanyaya. So we, you know, we say that he is a Guru Bhakti Shikhamani. So he is the most exalted of all the Sringeri Acharya Shishyas. So he is the Virudavali Guru Bhakti Shikhamani, Shastra Pradushana. So he is T.K. Balasubramanyaya, who was the founder of Sri Vani Vilas Press of Srirangam and Sri Shankara Gurukulam of Srirangam. So through his Vani Vilas Press, he had done yeoman service to Shankaracharya Sampradaya. So for the first time, he published all the works of Adi Shankara Bhagavatpada. For the first time, he published all the works, not all the works, but most works of Srimad Appaya Dikshitendra and the works of other Acharyas of our Sampradaya. During his time, Sri Sachidananda Tirtha Swamigal, who was a disciple of Jagadguru Shankaracharya, Sri Sachidananda Swabhinam Nrisimha Bharati Swamigal. So he gave an Upanyasam here in Sanskrit in the year 1941. And that was published in the journal of Sri Shankara Gurukulam. So I'm clear, you know, I'd like to reproduce that here in the Sannidhi of Sri Sharadamba, of Sri Adi Shankara Bhagavatpada, and Jagadguru Shankaracharya, Sri Sachidananda Shivabhinam Nrisimha Bharati Swamigal, where the same lecture was spoken 79 years ago. So this is what the Swamigal spoke. Srimad Shankara Bhagavatpada Dayohi नियामिमोध्यन्याः यथा निवृत्तिप्रधानमाश्रमं परिगृह्य निवृत्तिनिष्ठां स्वयमाचरणपूर्वकं परेभ्योऽपि प्रादिदृशन् तथैव श्रीमदप्पय्यदीक्षितेन्द्रादयोऽपि परमेश्वरावतारभूताः महापुरुषाः गृहस्थाश्रमं परिगृह्य प्रवृत्तिनिष्ठां स्वयमाचरणपूर्वकम् इतरेभ्योऽपि प्रादर्शयन् Shri Shankara Bhagavatpadadayohi Niyami Murdhanyaha. The crest jewel among sannyasis like Shri Adi Shankara Bhagavatpada, just like Shri Adi Shankara Bhagavatpada and others, accepted the Nivritti Pradhanam Ashramam or Sannyasa Ashramam, where Nivritti Nishtha is, is given preference. Nivritti Pradhanam Ashramam Parigrihya Vayamacharana Pradhanam, by observing the Nivritti Dharma themselves. So he also instructed his disciples in Nivritti Nishtha. Tathaiva Srimad Appaya Dikshitendra Adayopi. In the same way, the avatar purushas like Shri Appaya Dikshitendra accepted Grihastha Ashramam and instructed others on Pravritti Nishtha through example. And then he says, Yadyapi Shrimantaha Appaya Dikshitendradayaha Bahunam Vedanta Nibandhanam Upanibandhana Dvara Nivritti Nishthamapi Tattad Adhikaribhyaha Darshayantisma Yadyapi Shrimad Acharyendrascha Vayam Nivritti Nishthapi Vedo Nityam Adhiyatam Taduditam Karmasvanushthiyatam Ityadina Pravritti Margamapi Tattad Adhikaribhya Pradarshayanneva. So he says, although Dikshitendra followed the Pravritti Marga, he was not against the Nivritti Marga. He strongly advocated the Nivritti Marga. Yadyapi Srimanto Dikshitendra, so far to propagate the Nivritti Marga as well, Srimad Appaya Dikshitendra wrote many Vedanta Granthams. Shastra Siddhanta Lesha Sangraham is one example. Kalpataru Parimala Vyakhyanam is another example. So this is a commentary on Vachaspati Mishra's Bhamatika Tika is a direct commentary on Bhagavatpada's Brahma Sutra Bhashya. That Bhamati was commented upon by Swami Amalananda, and that commentary is known as Vedanta Kalpaturu. And Vedanta Kalpaturu, because it was very difficult to understand, Dikshitendra wrote a detailed commentary on it known as Kalpataru Parimala. And then he also wrote another independent commentary on the Brahma Sutra, named Nyaya Rakshamani. See, it's only for the first chapter of Brahma Sutras that Nyaya Rakshamani has been written. And then he wrote another commentary known as Nayamanjari. The first sutram of every Adhikaranam has been commented upon by Dikshitendra and Nayamanjari. And it is written in the form of shloka. So one shloka represents Purva Paksham, and the other shloka represents Siddhantam. And he has composed it with, he has used more than 185 rithams or meters. And it is a, the Nayamanjari is a monumental work. So it shows how great his knowledge was in Chanda Shastram, in Sahitya Shastram, and in Vedanta Shastram. Apart from that, he has written work like Upakrama Parakrama. So all of us have heard of Advaita Siddhi of Sri Madhusudana Saraswati Swamigal. Vyasatirtha Swamigal wrote a work called Nyayamritam as Khandanam on Advaitam. So to defend Advaita Vedantam against Vyasatirtha Swamigal's attacks, Madhusudana Saraswati Swamigal wrote Advaita Siddhi. In the same way, the same Vyasatirtha Swamigal wrote Tarkatandavam as a Khandanam on Advaitam, and Dikshitendra wrote Upakrama Parakrama as a defense against Tarkatandavam. But not many people today know about, have heard of Upakrama Parakrama. So this is one great work of Dikshitendra. So here, and then apart from that, we have got Madhvatantra Mukhamardhanam. So in this way, Bahunam Vedanta Nibandhanam Upanibandhana Dwara, Dikshitendra instructed Nivritti Nishtha to those disciples who were qualified for Nivritti Marga. And then once again, we come back to Sashidananda Tirtha Swamigal's Upanyasam. And then he says, Srimad Acharyendrascha Svayam Nivritti Nishtha Api. Although Bhagavad Pada was situated in the Nivritti Nishtha, he instructed his disciples who were qualified for Pravarti Marga through his words like Vedo Nityam Adhiyatam Taduditam Karmasvanushthiyatam. So this is from the first shloka of the famous Sadhana Panchakam of Bhagavad Pada. So he says, do Veda Dhyayanam regularly, Taduditam Karmasvanushthiyatam, perform all the Shrautasmartha Karmas in the prescribed way. So Taduditam Karmasvanushthiyatam Ityadina Pravritti Nishtham Api. So just like Bhagavad Pada instructed others, his disciples in Pravritti Margam, Tathapi Pravritti Marga Rakshane Eva Dikshitendranam Pradhanyena Pravrittihi Divritti Marga Rakshane Eva Srimad Acharyendranam Pradhanyena Pravrittiriti Cha Neda Matiparoksham Nama Prekshavatam Tadubhaya Charitra Vimarshana Vyasaninam. In spite of all that, so predominantly Dikshitendra's focus was to protect Pravritti Marga, and Sri Adi Shankara Bhagavad Pada's focus in his life was to protect Nivritti Marga. So anyone who study the charitams of both of these Mahatmas, this fact is very clear to them. So Neda Matiparoksham Nama Prekshavatam Tadubhaya Charitra Vimarshanavyasininam. So Swamigal says. And then again he continues, Shri Adi Shankar Bhagavat Padaha Ishvara Avatara Bhutaha Eva Iti Vishaye Chaturbhis Sahashishya Istu Shankarova Tarishyati Iti Shivarahasya Vachanayatha Pramanam Tathaiva Tatraiva Amshavatara Prakarane Dikshitopi Bhavet Kashchita Shaiva Chandoga Vamshajaha Ityadi Shivarahasya Vachanam Pramanam Bhavati. To prove the fact that Sri Adi Shankara Bhagavat Pada was an avatara of Parameshwara himself, so the words of Shivarahasya Puranam, Upapuranam, Chaturbhi Saha Shishya Istu Shankarovatarishyati. So, I mean, this is an evidence to prove that. So it means in Kali Yuga, the Lord is going to appear himself with four Shishyas. In the same way, Tathaiva, in the same way, Amshavatara Prakarane. So while explaining the Amshavataram, Tatraeva, in the same Shivarahasyam, in the same Prakaranam. So there is another passage which says, Dikshitopi Bhavet Kashchita. So there is going to be another Dikshita, a Brahmana who will be performing, an Agnihotri Brahmana. Shaivash Chandu, Shaivaha, a great devotee of Shiva. Chandoga Vamshajaha, means one who has taken birth in a family of Samaveda Brahmanas. So this is an evidence to prove that Dikshitendra was an avataram of Parameshwara himself in Kali Yuga. And then Swamigal says, Etesham Dikshitendranam avatara prayojanam cha bahuvidham asti. So there were many purposes for Dikshitendra's avataram. Grihastha dharmanam sakalyena svayam anushthana purvakam परेशामप्यनुष्ठापनं कृत्वा भगवत्प्रोक्त धर्मस्थापनम् एकम्. So by observing all the griha, all the dharmas prescribed for a grihastha brahmana, so he wanted to make others observe the grihastha dharma in the prescribed way. Pareshamapyanushthapanam kritva. So in this way, by doing this, he wanted to establish the vedokta dharma. So this is one purpose. And then number two is advaita pracharo dvitiyah. व्याससूत्राणां द्वैत विशिष्टाद्वैत परतयापि कश्चित् योजितानां तत्र स्वारस्य भंगमुपपाद्य अद्वैतमते एव स्वारस्यातिशयस्य आविष्करणद्वारा शंकरमतस्य पुनःप्रतिष्ठापनम्. सो नंबर टू इज द प्रोपगेशन ऑफ अद्वैत वेदांत. सो ओवर टाइम सम आचार्यस हैड कमेंटेड अपॉन द ब्रह्मसूत्रास फ्रॉम अ विशिष्टाद्वैतिक पर्सपेक्टिव and some from the dvaita, the dvaitic perspective. So to break the utsaha, of people on those interpretations of the Brahma Sutras, and to create an enthusiasm in the study of Advaita Vedanta, and to establish Bhagavatpada's religion once again in the society. So this was another purpose of Dikshitendra's avatar. शिवपारम्य प्रदर्शनेन शिवभक्ति प्रवर्तनम् ही सेज. सो बाय एस्टैब्लिशिंग द सुप्रीमेसी ऑफ लॉर्ड शिवा ही वांटेड टू प्रोपेगेट द मार्गम ऑफ शिवभक्ति. सो दिस इज द थर्ड प्रयोजन ऑफ दीक्षितेन्द्रास अवतारम. एंड द फोर्थ वन इज स्वकीया मानुष चरित्र प्रदर्शनेन नास्तिकानामपि वैदिक मार्गेषु श्रद्धोत्पादनम् इत्येवम् आदि. बाय एग्जिबिटिंग हिज अमानुष क्वालिटीज विच वर नो सुपर ह्यूमन, सो बाय एग्जिबिटिंग ऑल ऑफ दोस क्वालिटीज ही वांटेड टू क्रिएट एन इंटरेस्ट इन द माइंड्स ऑफ द नास्तिकास आल्सो टू टेक अप द पाथ ऑफ वैदिक धर्म. सो इत्येवम् आदि. सो दीस आर द पर्पस, दीस आर द एम्स ऑफ दीक्षितेन्द्रास अवतार. एंड देन ही गोज ऑन टू से श्रीमद् आचार्याणां अंतर्गर्भिताः आशय विशेषाः. सो ऑल्दो भगवत्पाद हैड रिटन हिज सूत्र भाष्यम, सो मेनी ऑफ द नो इन मेनी प्लेसेस इन हिज भाष्यम द मीनिंग वाज नॉट क्लियर. अंतर्गर्भिताः आशय विशेषाः दीक्षितेन्द्रैः यथास्तुति कृताः न तथा अन्यैः सेज सच्चिदानंद तीर्थ स्वामी. Just like Dikshitendra had explained in a clear and concise manner the secrets of Bhagavatpada's bhashyam, nobody else has explained them. Anandamaya adhikarnehi uccha brahmavada siddhantah yadyapi shrimad acharya prasadhitah tathapi tadiya vade sutradi nasvarasani. So in the Brahma Sutra, the first chapter and first padam of the Brahma Sutra, there is one adhikaranam known as Anandamaya adhikaranam. So there in Anandamaya Adhikaranam, some acharyas had raised allegations against Bhagavatpada, saying that his interpretations were going against the original purport of Sri Vyasacharya. So although Adishankara Bhagavatpada had explained very beautifully the Puchha Brahmavada here in Anandamaya Adhikaranam, although the tadiya vade sutrani nasvarasani, but the meaning of the sutras don't appear very clearly in Bhagavatpada's bhashyam. Yeah, this is what the Swamigal says. So the direct disciple of Jagadguru Shankaracharya, Shri Sachidananda Swabhin Narasimha Bharati Swami, so these are his own words here. And then he says, again, bahunam anandamay brahmavada eveti बहूनां स्परसत एव समुन्विशन्ति शंका दीक्षितेन्द्रैरेव सूत्रस्वारस्य विवरणपूर्वकं समूलमुन्मूलिता इति महदुपकृतमत्र दीक्षितवर्यैः. सो ऑल ऑफ द एलिगेशंस विच वर लेवल्ड अगेंस्ट भगवत्पाद, सो दीक्षितेन्द्र वाज द ओनली पर्सन हु हैड आंसर्ड देम बाय गिविंग अ वेरी ब्यूटिफुल समाधानम इन अ वेरी लॉजिकल एंड क्लियर मैनर. एंड देन ही सेज असाध्य यदि भाष्यकारैः यद्यपि असाधारणयः युक्तयः सूचिताः ऑल्दो आदिशंकर भगवत्पाद हैज गिवन मेनी डिफिकल्ट टू अंडरस्टैंड युक्तिज इन हिज भाष्यम सो इट इज दीक्षितेंद्र हु हैज एक्सप्लेन्ड ऑल ऑफ दोस युक्तिज इन द क्लियरेस्ट मैनर पॉसिबल अगेन इत्थम बहूनां बहुविध शंका निराकरण पूर्वकम परिमल न्यायरक्षामण्यादि ग्रंथजातम् अनुगृहीतवतां तेषाम् उपकारभरः न केनापि विस्मर्तुं पार्यते संस्कृतज्ञेन इन दिस वे इत्थम् बाय रिमूविंग मेनी डिफरेंट काइंड्स ऑफ डाउट्स दीक्षितेन्द्र हैड कंपोज्ड वर्क्स लाइक परिमलम् न्यायरक्षामणि परिमल न्यायरक्षामण्यादि ग्रंथजातम् अनुगृहीतवतां तेषाम् उपकारभरः such a great contribution of Dikshitendra can never be forgotten by anyone who knows Sanskrit language. Itham pragalha panditya-vatam apyetesham prachinacharyeshu tad vachaneshu va katidha gaurava buddhirasita kiyati cha vinatata bhuta iti cha tat tat grantha parishilinam eva sthutam. In this way, pragalha panditya-vatam, although he had a very great panditya, pragalbha, which means both in depth as well as in breadth, he had a very great panditya, pragalbha panditya vatama pyetesham. So although he had such a great panditya, he never expressed even the slightest disrespect towards any of the prachina acharya. He had immense respect for all the prachina acharyas like Adishankar Bhagavatpada and others, and that it could be known only by those who study his works in detail. तत्त ग्रंथ परिशीलिनामेव स्फुटं से स्वामिगण एंड देन ही कंक्लूडेड द भाष्य द भाषणम सेइंग इत्थम अद्वैत विद्या जीवातु भूतानां शिव परावताराणां तेषां महापुरुषाणां सो ही सेज स्वामिगण सेज दैट श्रीमद् अप्पय्य दीक्षितेन्द्र वास जीवातु सो इट मींस जीवातु मींस लाइफलाइन ऑफ द होल ऑफ अद्वैत द ट्रेडिशन ऑफ अद्वैत विद्या अगेन परमेश्वरावतार भूतानां Once again, he says that Dikshitendra was an avataram of Parameshwara. So, tesham nirantara smaranena diname vedam sudinam samajani. So this day has been very beautiful by his smaranam. And again, in the same way, prativatsaram api, every year in the forthcoming years, Dikshitendra punya dinacharanena sarvepi kritarthi bhavantu ityashasyate. So by observing Dikshitendra Punyacharanam here, that is in the Srirangam Shankara Gurukulam, that is Sringeri Matham here in Srirangam. So Swamigal had expressed this desire that every year Dikshitendra Jayanti has to be observed consistently every year. So he says, Sarvepi Kritarthi Bhavantu, so let everyone become Kritarthas, Ityashasyate. And I would like to paraphrase the word saying, I would like to paraphrase Swamigad's word saying iti prarthaye. So evam dikshitendranam punya dinacharanena sarvepi kritarthi bhavantu iti prarthaye aashasite means to pronounce blessing. So because he was a very old sannyasi at 1941, he must have been above 70 or 80 years old at that time. So being a sannyasi and being a person who was very old, very old. So he could pronounce Ashirvadam. So being a youngster, I cannot say that. So I say here as Prarthiya in the Sannidhi of Sharadamba, Bhagavatpada and Acharya. So both in Srirangam as well as in every place where Adishankara Acharya's Jayanti is observed, every single place, so every following of Adishankara Bhagavatpada must celebrate the Jayanti of Dikshitendra as well. So this is my humble prarthana to everyone worldwide. So people celebrate the Jayantis of all the Sringeri Shankaracharyas with great bhakti and shraddha. People celebrate the Aradhana of Mahatmas like Sri Sadashiva Brahmendra. Aradhana Mahotsavams of Sri Tyagaraja Swamigale celebrated with great bhakti and shraddha. So the Punyadana Acharanams connected to many Mahatmas in our Sampradayam is being celebrated by all of us with great bhakti and shraddha everywhere. So in the same way, Asetu Himachalam, all the followers of Adi Shankara Bhagavatpada, must celebrate Srimad Appaya Dikshitendra Jayanti every year and not just Dikshitendra Jayanti alone. So every year we must celebrate Dikshitendra Jayanti. So which comes in Kanya Masam's Krishna Paksha Prathama. So we should also celebrate the day when he attained Sahaja Bhukti in Chidambaram Kshetram. So on the day of Chaitra Purvima, he merged with the deity of Chidambaram Dasaraja. So So it is my humble request to all the followers of Bhagavad Pada that Dikshtendra Jayanti and the day of his Sahaja Prapti be celebrated everywhere. So shall I conclude the speech with here, or do we still have time? I think it's 7:15. So do we still have time to speak something more?
You have time. 15 yeah? minutes.
Okay, 15 minutes. Okay. So this is about, I've just introduced the life of Srimad Appaya Dikshitendra now. So I'd like to begin the the Katha Bhagam of Dikshitendra Vijayam. So tomorrow and day after tomorrow, I'll be speaking on the Katha, the story of Srimad Appaya Dikshitendra. Who was Appaya, who was Dikshitendra, what were the events that took place in his life? So the basic, three texts which I use as pramanam for this are number one, Dikshitendra Vamshabharanam of Mahamahopadhyaya, Ityagnihotri Shri Mannargudi Raju Shastrigal. So he was one of the direct descendants of Dikshitendra. He was Nityagnihotri and a great scholar in all the four Shastras. So he wrote a very short work known as Dikshitendra Vamshabharanam. So that is one textbook for reference. The other two is Dikshitendra Vijayam. This is a Champu Kavyam in Sanskrit written by Shivananda Yogindra. He was known as Shesha Dikshitar in his Purvashramam. He was a resident of Kadayam Agraharam in Tirunelveli district. He took sannyasam later on and he wrote a work known as Dikshitendra Vijayam. So that is the second work. And the third work is the Dikshitendra Vijayam. This is also a Champu Kavyam written by K.V. Subramanya Shastri. And interestingly, all the three of them were descendants of Dikshitendra. K.V. Subramanya Shastrigal was also a descendant of Dikshitendra. Shivananda Yogindra was also a Dikshitendra. Mannargudi Raju Shastrigal was also a descendant of Dikshitendra. So now I'd like to begin the Kathabhagam of Dikshitendra Vijayam. So there was one great scholar known as A.V. Gopalacharya in Srirangam. So he was Mimamsa Ratnam, Rishi advocate, Pandit A.V. Gopalaratnam. He was a great scholar in Purva Mimamsa Shastram, in both Advaita Vedantam and Vishishta Advaita. He was a Sri Vaishnava by birth. He was a close friend of Sri T.K. Balasubramanya Iyer. And he was one of the editors of the journal of Sri Shankara Gurukulam. So a journal, an Advaitic journal. And so he says, he was a close friend of Sri T.K. Balasubramanya Iyer also. So in his introduction to the life of Dikshitendra, so he says, it is with the feelings of deepest reverence and greatest admiration that we approach the life of Srimad Appaya Dikshitendra, than whom the world has never seen a profounder scholar or a more devout bhakta. There is a halo of sanctity around the name of our great hero, for certainly he was one of the greatest heroes of this country, and the very thought of him will not fail to inspire the warmest and holiest feelings in any right-thinking person who has had the fortune to read his immortal works. The word Dikshita means one who has performed the sacrifice. Sacrifices have been performed in this country, time without beginning, by countless persons. But from the mountain to the cave, the word Dikshita, without any further description, has come to attach itself exclusively to the great soul from whose pen emerged the commentary upon the Yadavabhyudaya Mahakavya. So Dikshitendra had written an elaborate commentary upon the Yadavabhyudaya Mahakavya of Sri Vaishnavacharya Swami Vedanta Deshika. And K.V. Subramanya, yes?
Paduka Sastra also.
But Paduka Sastra Vyakhya of Dikshitendra is not available today. So it is a Lupta Grantham today. So a few works of Dikshitendra have been lost, so we don't get those works today. So Paduka Sastra Vyakhya of Dikshitendra is one such work today. And K.V. Subramanya Shastrigal says in his Dikshitendra Vijayam, Asti Tundira Mandale Sumanasamavasa Bhuta Dharanimavati Irna Maravati Virajamana Moksha Purishu Saptasvanyatama Shri Kanchi Nama Rajathani Jagarti Chayatra Prithivyakriti Karuna Varunalaya Bhaktajana Chintamani Kashri Kamakshi Sanasaha Ekamranatha Nama Parameshwaraha. So this is a Gadyam. It's a prose. So it says, Asti Tundira Mandala. Tundira Mandala means Tundai Mandala. So in present day Tamil Nadu, the districts of Chennai, Kanchipuram, Velur, Arkad, so and then Thiruvannamalai, so all of these command are ancient Tundira Mandalam. And then Sumanasama means of great scholars. Sumanasama Avasabhuta means which was a resident of great scholars, of great Mahatma. Sumanasama Avasabhuta. And then Dharadimavati Rinam Aravati. So Amaravati is the city of the Devatas. So of the city of the Devas. So it appeared as Amaravati that had descended down on the earthly planet. Amaravati va Virajamana. And then Bharata Bhumehe Nabhi Mandalasthanam Upeyushi. So which is considered as the Nabhi Mandalasthanam of the Bharatavarsha. And then Sapta Moksha Purishu. So this is one among the seven Moksha Purishu. Ayodhya, Mathuramaya, Kashi, Kanchi, Yavantika, Puri, Dwaravati, Chaiva. So this is one of the seven Moksha Purishu. Sapta Svanyatamashi, Kanchi, Nama Rajadhani. So this was the capital of the Pallavati. Then Jagrati Chayatra. So in this holy Kshetram. So Lord, we've got the temple of Ekamranathar in this holy Kshetram. And then, so not very far from this holy Kshetram of Kanchipuram, lies an Agraharam, lies a holy town known as Thiruvirinchipuram. And very close to that Thiruvirinchipuram, lies the Agraharam known as Adayappalam. And then he says, so this Adayappalam Agraharam, so this were many Brahmanas lived in this Adayappala Agraharam. So how were the Brahmanas who lived there? And then he says, Varnashramacharanushthana nishthaihi. And then anavadya hadya gadya padya prabandha nirmana nipunaihi. Pravabhasha vichakshanaihi. Labdha santushtaihi. And then he says, Havyagandhidhuma patali pavitrikritavasathaihi pandita prakandaihi. Abhimanditaha Adayappalakhyo graharaha. Again, so the Brahmanas who resided in this Adayappala Agraharam were, so they were great pandita, the best among pandita. So they were very strict in their observance of Varnashrama Anushthanam. And then there are very great scholars. They used to compose many anavadhya means, without any break, hridya, anything that is very beautiful. Then Gadhya Padhya Prabandha Nirmanam, then composing Gadhyams and Padhyams means shlokas in poetry that are very beautiful to hear. And then Anavadhyas, anything that can, Grantham against which no objections can be raised. Anavadhya Hridya Gadhya Padhya Prabandha Nirmanam Nipunaihi. And then Labdha Santushtaihi. They were content with whatever they got. So this is Lakshanam of a Brahmana. And then Havyaganti Dhuma Patali Pavitri Kritavasatihi. How were their houses? All of their houses were purified by the ceiling of all their houses was full of the soot which emanates from Agni Devata. So he denotes that every day they used to perform innumerable Nitya Karmas, so innumerable Vaidika Karmas used to be performed. So because of that, all the ceilings would appear very dark in color, the ceilings would appear very black in color. So in this way, all the houses of those Brahmanas were purified. So Tadrishahi Pandita Prakandaihi Abhimanditaha. So it was decorated by such Pandita Prakaras Adayappalakshograharaha. In that Adayappalagrahara lived a Brahmana known as Vakshasthalacharya. He was a very great, again, Subramanya Shastri describes him as someone who was similar to Vasishtha Maharishi in the performance of Vaidika Karmanushtanam. When it comes to teaching the Brahma Sutra, he was as great as Adi Shankara Bhagavatpada. Again, he belonged to the Bharadvaja Gotra. He was an upasaka of Vakshasthala Ganapati. And then he was known as Acharya Dikshitar or Vakshasthala Acharya. Again, in his Sanskrit commentary, known as this Vakshasthala Acharya was the grandfather of Dikshitendra. And Dikshitendra says in his commentaries, Nyaya Rakshamani and Shivarkamani Deepika. So Shivarkamani Deepika is a commentary on Shrikantha Shivacharya's Brahma Sutra Bhashya. So again, in both of these works, one and the same shloka is written in Guru Vandana shloka, as in Mangalacharanam part of it. Asetu bandha tatam acha tushara shailat acharya dikshita iti prathitabhidhanam advaita chitsukha mahambudhi magnabhavam asmat pitamahamashesha gurum prapadye. Asetu bandha tatam acha tushara shailat. Asetu bandha tatam is Rameshwaram. from the shores of Rameshwara Kshetram, Acha Tushara, Tushara is no Tushara Shalim is Himalaya Parvatam. Until the Himalaya Parvatam in the north, Acharya Dikshita Iti Prasita Abhidhanam. So his name was known by the name of Acharya Dikshita. Then Advaita Chitsukhamaham Buddhimakna Bhavam. So he was completely immersed in the supreme bliss of Advaita Chitsukam. So Asmat Pitamaham. So I take refuge under the lotus feet of my grandfather. So he was a great Advaita Vidyacharya. So he says, Atma Asmat Pitamaham Asamaham Sharanam Prapadhyay. And then he also says in his words like Shikharini Mala. So he says that his grandfather had observed very great Yajnam Shrauta Karmas like Sarvato Mukham and Mahamahavrata. Shri Sarvato Mukha Mahabrata Yajisu Noho. So he says in the, at the end of his Shikharini Mala. So Bakshasthalacharya was patronized by the Raja of Vijayanagaram. So Vijayanagara Raja was a great disciple and bhakta of Bakshasthalacharya. Once in Kanchipuram, when Bakshasthalacharya and Krishnadevaraya were standing in the Varadaraja Vasantotsavam, so they were standing in front of the Murti of Varadaraja. So with great humility and bhakti, the Vijayanagara Raja, so he implored Bakshasthalacharya to compose a shlokam on Varadaraja Swami. And immediately he spoke a shloka in praise of Varadaraja. And this shloka has been quoted by Dikshitendra in his birth known as Chitra Mimamsa. And this is one of his magna opera in Alankara Shastra. So this is the shloka. Kanchi Kanchana Gaurangi Dikshya Sakshadivashriyam Varadas Samshayapannaha Vakshastalam Avekshate. Kanchi, on seeing someone, I mean he is addressing the Mahishi of the Raja, the Raja's queen. So he says that Maharani, Shri was such that, so she was Kanchana Gaurangi, so it appeared like molten gold. Vikshya Saksha Divashriyam, so she appeared as Lakshmi Devi descended on Saksha Divashriyam on seeing the queen. So Varadaha Samshayapanaha, Varadaraja Swami gets out of Samshayapanaha, Bakshastalam Avekshate. So he sees his Bakshastalam, his bosom. So again, there are three Samshaya Alankarams explained by Dikshitendra here. So now the first Samshaya Alankaram here is, so he says that, whose beauty is more beautiful? Lakshmi Devi's beauty is more beautiful, or Vijayanagara Mahishi's beauty is more beautiful. So Varadaraja wanted to see whose beauty was more beautiful. So Varadaha Samshayapannaha Vakshasthalamai Vikshate, he looked at his chest. And then there is another Samshayakaram. On seeing someone whose beauty surpassed her own beauty, wow, what is the face expression of Lakshmi Devi? So to see how Lakshmi Devi reacted, Varadaha Samshayapannaha Vakshasthalam Avekshate. So getting a doubt, Varadaraja Swami looked at his chest. And then the third Samshayakaram is, so because she appeared as Lakshmi Devi herself, so he wanted to see where shall I place this Lakshmi within my Vakshasthalam. And hence Varadaha Samshayapannaha Vakshasthalam Avekshate. So he wanted to, so he had a samshayam here and he looked at his chest. So being very happy hearing this shloka, so the Vijayanagara Raja, so he named him as Bakshasthalacharya. So he did not name him immediately as Bakshasthalacharya. So he took sought his permission. He prayed him fervently and he asked him if he could give him such a namadhey. And then when Bakshasthalacharya accepted it, and then blessed him, it was only then the Maharaja gave him the name Vakshasthalacharya. And then Neelakantha Dikshita of Palamadai, so who was the grandson of Dikshitendra's younger brother Achan Dikshita. So he says in his Sanskrit drama known as Nalacharita Natakam, Tasya cha Krishna Raja Vandita Charanaravindasya Bharadvaja Kulachudamanehe Ashtabhish Kratubhi Ashtabhirayatanishcha Shambhoho Ashtabhis Tatakaihi Ashtabhishcha Sarjavidya Visha Vivisharadaihi Tanayaihi Ashtapidishaha Yashobhir Jvalitaha. Tasyacha of that Bakshasthalacharya, whose lotus feet were worshipped by the Krishnadeva, the Vijayanagara Raja Krishnadeva Raya. So all of the eight directions, all of his eight directions were illuminated with Ashtabhihi, Ashtabhihi Kratubhihi, eight great Shrauta Yajnams which he performed. Ashtabhirayatanishya Shambhoho. By eight temples in eight different places he had erected. Ashtabhistatataihi. By eight ponds which he had constructed. And then Ashtabhihi Sarvavidya Visharadaihi Parihi. By eight sons who were great scholars in all the Vidyas. Tasya Panchamasunuhu. Fifth son of that Vakshasthalacharya was Advaita Vidya Mukura Vivarana Darpana Aneka Dvaita Prabandha Nirmata Shilita Eva Rangaraja Dvariti. So he was the composer of great works in Advaita Vedanta like Advaita Vidyamukuram, Vivarana Darpanam and others. So he was, Rangaraja Dvari was the fifth son of this Vakshasthalacharya. And how did he, so again there is Dikshitendra Vamshabharanam. Mannargudi Rajashastri gives a very beautiful story. So this was heard through Karna Parampara and this is recorded in Dikshitendra Vamshabharanam. So the Vakshasthalacharya had two wives. So the elder wife was a Smartha and the younger wife was a Sri Vaishnava. So the senior wife had four sons and the junior wife had four sons. So once when Vakshasthalacharya and Vijayanagara Raja had gone to some other place and he was returning back to Adayapalam. So during the Sayam Sandhya, so during the time of Sayam Sandhya, so all of them got down near a pond which happened to locate near an agraharam of Sri Vaishnava Brahmana. So Vakshasthalacharya got down there. He performed his Sayam Sandhya Anushthanam, his Aupasanam and Sayam Agnihotram. So very young girls who were below 10 years old, so they came to see the new person who had come to their agraharam. Again, when the sun began to start setting, all of them got scared of their parents and they all of them went home. If we stay here, our parents will get, we'll be punished by our parents severely. So we shouldn't stay here further. Apparently, all of them went back to their homes and only one girl was staying there. And when Vakshasthalacharya finished his anushthanam, he asked this girl, why are you standing here alone? Why have you not gone back to your house when all of your friends have returned back? She started crying and she said, my father has decided to get me married off to a very old Brahmana and I don't want to get married to a very old and invalid Brahmana. So again, in your sannidhanam, so I'm not alone. Friend Sulita, when she spoke this to him, he understood her akutam. And then immediately he took her on his palanquin and he took her to his agraharam. And then again, 600 years ago, you can just imagine what kind of consequence it would have created. And then all the Brahmanas of the Agraharam headed by the girl's father. So they came to Vakshasthalacharya's place. And then Vakshasthalacharya had ordered the Maharaja to take care of the Sri Vaishnava Brahmanas who would come and confront them. Again, the Sri Vaishnava Brahmana, he comes and he shouts at the Maharaja very badly and then the Raja pacifies him and then he says that so his daughter has been, she has gone to the right place and he doesn't have to worry about her. He was a very great person, he was a young person. He was highly patronized by many great kings and when he spoke about all the gunas of Vakshasthalacharya. And then he told that it's because of poverty that the Brahmana he was forced to give away his daughter to a very old and invalid Brahmana. So the Raja said, whatever money you need, you tell me, I can give you. And the Raja gave him a lot of Suvarna, he made a lot of Svarna Danam to the Brahmana. And the Brahmana felt happy. And then the marriage ceremony of Vakshasthalacharya and the Sri Vaishnava girl Totarambha took place. And at the end of the marriage, the Sri Vaishnava Brahmana, whose name was Rangarajacharya or Vaikunthacharya. So he blessed both Vakshasthalacharya and his daughter Totarambha. And he made one request to his son-in-law. He said, the very first son who will be born to you and my daughter, he should be named after me. And true to his promise, even Rangarajacharya or Vaikunthacharya was such a great Mahatma. So he was also a Vedavita. So that is why his word, you know, his words came true, and Vakshasthala Acharya had the first child that was born to them was a son, and that son was named as Rangaraja, Rangaraja. Again, in his Parimala Vyakhyanam in the chapter 1 in Padam 3, again, Dikshitendra says in his Parimala Vyakhyanam, Vaikuntha Charya Vamsham Budhihimakirana Srimadadvaita Vidyacharya Shri Rangaraja Vayavisritayasho Vishwajit Vyajisunoho Granthe Kalpat Dvara Parimale Sarvajit Vyajinospin Purnapadojanishta Bhamarahitahite Vivishesha Pradhanaha. So Vaikuntha, the very first verse, Vaikuntha Charya Vamsham Budhi Rangaraja, so Dikshitendra's father Rangaraja Dvari Rangaraja Dikshita. So he was the son, the grandson of the maternal grandson of Vaikuntha, Dauhitra of Vaikunthacharya. So in this way, so this is the katha behind Vakshasthalacharya's marriage with the Sri Vaishnava girl and the birth of Dikshitendra's father Rangaraja Dvari. And I'd like to conclude the lecture with this, and I would like to conclude it with the words of Sri A.V. Gopalacharya once again. And here once again A.V. Gopalacharya says that because Dikshitendra had Sri Vaishnava blood running through his veins, so he was able to comment upon texts like Yadavabhyudayam in the way Sri Vaishnava scholar would do. So even many concepts that could be studied and that understood only by Sri Vaishnavas who have had Shiksha in the Rahasya Grantham of the Sri Vaishnavas, in Vishishta Advaitam, only they can comment upon certain texts. Again, in Anandamaya Adhikarana, again, he draws a parallel between Dikshitendra and Vyasatirtha Swamigal. So, although Vyasatirtha Swamigal, he was a very great scholar. He had a very asadharana panditim in many systems of Vidya. In his Nyayamritam in Anandataratamyavadam, while explaining the Vishishta Advaita Siddhantam, he makes very small mistakes, although those are excusable mistakes. Even such a great scholar like Vyasatirtha Swamigal makes very small mistakes. Even there, Srimad Apayadikshitendra never makes such mistakes. So this has been told by a great scholar who was both a Vishishta Advaita, a great scholar in Vishishta Advaitam, as well as an Advaita Vedantam. So with this, I would like to conclude today's Bhashanam. And in tomorrow's Bhashanam, we shall see the Katha of Rangaraja Advari, and then how Dikshitendra's Jananam took place. And then until the leela of his composing of the commentary Shivarkamani Deepika. So with this I would like to conclude. Hara Namah Parvati Pataye Har Har Mahadeva.
Om Sada Shiva Samarambham Shankaracharya Madhyamam Asmadacharya Paryantam Vande Guru Paramparam Shankarupena Machittam Panki Kritam Abhutyaya Kimkariyasya Samaya Shankaracharya Mashtraye Prahladavarado Devo Yonrasimha Parobharihi Nrasimhopasakam Nityam Tam Nrasimha Gurum Bhaje Sri Satchidananda Shiva Binavya Nrasimha Bharatya Bitanyatindran Vidyanitin Mantra Nitim Sadatmanishtan Bhaje Manava Shambhurupan Sadatmatyana Niratam Vishayebhyav Param Mukam Naumi Shastreshu Nishnatam Chandra Shekhara Bharatim Vivekinam Mahapragyam Dairyau Dharyakshamanitim Sada Binava Purvantam Vidya Tirtha Gurum Bhaje Agyanam Jhanna Vitirtham Vidya Tirtham Vivekinam Sarvesham Shukadam Tirtham Bharati Tirtham Ashraye Vidya Vinaya Sampannam Vitaragam Vivekinam Vande Vedanta Tatpagyam Vidu Shekhara Bharatim
Idam charangam tyajatami hangam navidyate engaya divastu changam panau rathangam shayane bhujangam yane vihangam charane chadangam kaveri tatashobhiranga nagara prabhaga jambhutaru prantodyanmani sattva nisthitamadhaha jambhutaro sthayinaha lute bharchitaranganatha varadam Bhaktyakhilandeshwari Puja Nirmita Satjalakriti Dharam Shri Jambunatham Bhaje Shruti Smriti Purananam Alayam Karunalayam Namami Bhagavat Padam Shankaram Vimoka Shankaram Shri Matkshi Ratarangini Tatagate Punge Virinche Pure नित्यं सन्निहितं किला कलयितुं क्षीराभिषेकादरं श्रीगारुत्मतवल्लिका सहचरं मार्गे सहायं नृणां श्रीमद्दीक्षितविप्रदैवतवरं सञ्चिन्तये शङ्करम् अप्पय्य दीक्षितेन्द्रान् अशेष विद्या गुरुनहं वन्दे यत्कृतिबोधा बोधौ विद्वद विद्वद्विभाजकोपाधि In yesterday's talk, I spoke about the story of Sri Vakshasthala Acharya. In today's talk, I'll be introducing who are Sri Rangaraja Dhvari today. Sri Vakshasthala Acharya had two wives, just like Surya Bhagavan had two wives, Chhaya Devi and Subharchala Devi. The younger wife, Totaramba, had four sons. Shri K.V. Subramanya Shastri will say, Tayoho dvitiyayam sahadharmacharinyam prasuteshu chaturshu putreshu vayasa yashasa mahasacha jyayam sah rangarajadhvarinah. Among the two wives, the younger wife had four sons. Among the four sons of the younger wife, the senior most was Shri Rangarajadhvari. He was also senior to them by fame and by prowess of all kinds. And in the, there is a very beautiful Gadhyam which Sri K.V. Subramanya Shastrigal says, and this is a very beautiful description of the greatness of Rangarajadhvari. So people who have studied Sanskrit must have studied Shabda Rupam. So there is, so all of us know that there are seven vibhaktis in Sanskrit grammar. With each vibhakti, by using yat shabda, K.V. Subramanya Shastri describes the glories of Sri Rangaraja Dikshita. So he says, Rangaraja Dharinaha ye diganta vishranta yashasam dikshitendranam pitrasthanochitam bhagya paripaka paramparama pedire yeshamcha mukharabinda vivikandarata Nirargala Nirargalachastra Pravachana Jharaihi Vidusham Samshaya Pankaha Akshalyanta Yaischa Grathitaha Advaita Vidyamukura Vivarana Darpanadayaha Aneka Advaita Prabandhaha Ushagra Buddhi Bhiradriyante Ebhyaha Vakya Patava Vrjita Vichakshana Gane Ebhyaha Vojati Shahi Saraswati Vilasaha Bhumipalaha Sabhadhyakshata Mangi Karajitamastrhayanta Yebhyascha adhita veda veda arthaha vangmukha pratoshita vibhudhavarga antevasi vichayaha vishobhidishascha vyanashire yeshamcha mukharabinda givikandarat nirargala nirargalachastra prabachana jharaihi vidusham samshaya pankaha akshalyanta yeshucha kalani dhichudamani nishtha sarvatishajini bhakti paripati samaydhata. So the word yachabda, so the bahuvachanam of yachabda, ye yam yaihi yebhyaha yebhyaha yesha yesham yeshu. So all of these of in the seven segments of this prose or gadhyam, the yachabdam gets its anvayam with the word rangaraja dvarinaha, which is also written in bahuvachanam. Ye Diganta Vishranta Yashasam Dikshitendranam Pitrasthanochitam Bhagya Paripaka Paramparama Pedire. So Vishva Rangaraja Dikshita attained the eminent status of being the father of Mahatma Srimad Appaya Dikshitendra and Yanscha Medhavinaha Anavaratam Patha Pravachana Niratana Advaita Vidyacharya Vadyan Sabhasu Sumedhasa Prashamsanti. Yansha Medhavinaha. So the word Medhavi means a person who is very high intellect. And then Sabhasu, Sumedhasaha. So great scholars, great intellectuals praise him as a very great Advaita Vidyacharya who's always absorbed, who's always engaged in teaching the Shastras to his disciples. Patha Pravachana Niratan Advaita Vidyacharya Varyan Sabhatu Sumedhu Prasham Santi. And then Yaischa Grathitaha So the works like Advaita Vidya Mukuram and Vivarana Darpanam composed by who? Yaischa Grathitaha Advaita Vidya Mukura Vivarana Darpanadayaha Aneka Advaita Prabandhaha. So these are being accepted by those who are extremely intellect, Kushagra Buddhi Bhi. So people who are highly intellect, then Yebhyaha Vakya Patavavarjita Vichakshan Agnebhyaha. So benevolent kings on whom Saraswati Devi's Kataksham gleamed. So all of those kings implored Rangaraja Dikshita to come to their own courts and accept the position of Sabha Pandita. So the Sabha Susu, then Yebhyaha Adhitaha, again the students who studied under him. And then Visho Vidishashtra Vyanashiri, after completing their studies, they went and settled in different parts of the land. Visho Vidishashtra Vyanashiri, and then Yeshamcha Mukharavinda Girikandarat. So from whose lotus mouth that resembled the mountain cave, Nirargala Shastra Pravachana Jarehi. So the Pravachanam of Shastra, so the Shastra Patham emanated like an uninterrupted cataract. So like an uninterrupted waterfall, Shastra Pravachanam emanated from his Mukharavindam. And through that, Vidushan Samshaya Pankaha. So the slush of scholars, doubts in the Shastras, Akshalyanta, they get washed away. Yeshucha, in whom? Kalanidhi Chudamani Nishtha, Bhakti Paripati, devotion to the Supreme Lord Parameshwara. It kept on in the Kalanidhi Chudamani Nishtha, Sarvati Shagini. So something which was which was in abundance. Samai Bhada, it kept increasing over time. And then Srimad Appaya Dikshitendra talks about him in his commentary, Shivatkamani Deepika and Nyaya Rakshamani. So he says, Yam Brahma Nishchata Dhiya Prabhadanti Sakshat Yad Darshana Dakhila Darshana Parabhajaha Tam Sarva Veda Samashesha Budhadhirajam. So he says the meaning of the shloka means Yam Brahma Nishchita Dhiya. So the word Brahma Nishchita Dhiya means self-realized souls. So Dhihi means intellect. So people whose intellect is situated in the Supreme Brahman, Brahma Nishchita Dhiya. And then Akhila Darshana Parabhajaha. So who are great, highly learned in all the Darshana, Sakala Darshana, all the six Nastika Darshanas and the six Astika Darshanas. So such realized men, Yam Sakshat Brahma Pravadanti. So who describes Shri Rangarajadhari as the Supreme Brahman itself. Tam Sarva Vedasam. So the word Sarva Vedas means there is a Shrauta Yajnam known as Sarva Vishvajita. So a person who has performed Vishvajit Yajnam is known as Vaishvajit or Sarva Vedas. So Stam Sarva Vedasam and Ashesha Buddhadi. So the Yajnam known as Vishvajit, the person who performs it is expected to give away all that he has in possession. So he's supposed to give everything that he has, and he must lead a life of poverty till the end of his life. So Rangaraja Dikshitar had performed that kind of a yajna. Tam sarva vedasam ashesha buddhadhirajam shri rangarajam akhinam pitaram natosmi. So I bow down to my father Shri Rangaraja Dhvari. So this is what he said. And then in his commentary known as Kalpataru Parimalam, so he describes the greatness of his father once again. ूषित भट्टमतम विमलाधियम महतामतम विदुषा विनिवेश गुरु हृदय वैश्वजित नय संहतिशालिनी कल्पतरौ Ivritascharana prathama prathitaha, says Dikshitendra. So these three shlokas appear in the Brahma Sutras chapter 1 and at the end of Padam 1 of chapter 1. Hridi Gurum Vinivesya Nayamoktika Shalini Kalpatarau Prathitaha Prathamaha Charanaha Vivritaha. So this is the anvayam of the shlokas. Hridi in my heart, Gurum Vinivesya. So that means by meditating upon my Guru in my heart, Hridi Gurum Vinivesya. Again, I commence upon the this work. So he says it's after doing, after performing Guru Vandanam. The first padam of the first chapter of Brahma Sutras under Kalpataru, Nayamoktika Shalini Kalpataru, the first padam has been, Vivritaha means it has been explained. And the word Nayamoktika Shalini, Naya means, so a lot of Yukti, Nayamoktika is Yukti Bhuvisham. So it means because the Kalpataru Parimala Vyakhyanam of Deepshitendra is abundantly supplied with a lot of Purva Mimamsa Nyayams throughout the text. So, Nayamoktika Shalini Kalpatarau, the first padam of first chapter has been explained. And then he explains, the word Guru is being explained once again. What kind of Guru was he? Kana Bhakshapa Dakshaka Paksha Pareshkara Nakshana Takshana Dakshagiram. Kana Bhaksha is Kanada Maharshi, the author of Vaisheshika Sutras. Padakshaka is Gautama Harshi, the author of Nyaya Sutra, Nyaya Darshanam. Kana Bhaksha Padakshaka, Pakshapa, Paksham is the Siddhantam of Nyayam and Vaisheshika Darshanam. The Parishkaranam means Bhushanam. To explain these two Darshanams, and then Paksha Parishkarana Kshane Eva means simultaneously by explaining the tenets of these two schools of philosophies. Takshanam. Takshanam means Chedana Karma. So Chedana Karmani, in refuting it, some aspects of these as untenable. So Tasmin Karmani. Daksha means Patutara. Gihi Yasya. Gihi Patutara. The word Daksha means capable. Gihi is Vakyam. So Patutara Dakshagihi Yasya. So he is Kana Bhakshapa Dakshaka Paksha Pareshkara Nakshana Takshana Dakshagihi. And then Atikarkasha Tarkasha Taksha. Atikarkasha means extremely difficult arguments. Atikarkasha Tarkas means extremely difficult arguments. Through such arguments, through hundreds of such arguments, Tesham Shataihi. Shatak Shubhitaihi. Shubhitam means anything that has been analytically studied, and then kshapitam means kshayam nitam, anything that has been reduced in the society. Kshapitam cha kshapana ati karkasha tarkasha takshubhita kshapita kshapana kshana bhanga patam kshap kshana bhanga sar Jains, and then the Jains and the Buddhists. So it means that Rangaraja Dikshar has worked towards reducing the influence of the Buddhists and the Jains in the land. Kapilokti Nirakarana Pravanam. Kapilokti is Sankhya Darshanam. Kapilokti Nirakaranam means to refute it. Nirakarane Pravanam means one who is steeped in it. Kapilokti Nirakarana Pravanam. Kritapannaga Sukti Parishkaranam. Kritam means vihitam or written. Pannaga Sukti, Pannaga is snake, the word Pannaga is Patanjali Maharshi here. He is Krita Pannaga Sukti Parishkarana. So it means Rangaraja Dhvari has also written a commentary. Mahatamapi manyatamam vidusham. Mahatamapi vidusham manyatamam. Sri Rangaraja Dhvari was highly respectable even among the great scholars. So I bow down to my Guru Sri Rangaraja Dhvari. So this is the greatest of Sri Rangaraja Dikshita. So although Rangaraja Dikshitar was endowed with all fortune in his life, he did not have one fortune alone in his life, and that was Putra Sampat. He did not have any children. So just like Adi Shankara Bhagavatpada's father Shivaguru Dikshitar did not have any children. So Shankar Vijayam says that Shri Rangaraja Shivaguru, so he was freed from two runams. So any Brahmana who takes birth, so he is born with three debts. So the word runam in Sanskrit means debts. Jayamano havai brahmanah tribhihi runaihi runavan jayate. Again, when a Brahmana takes birth, he is born with three debts. So one is Rishiranam, debts to the devatas, and then Pitruanam is the third one. Pitruanam means debts to the ancestors, the deceased ancestors. By studying the Vedas and observing Brahmacharyam, a Brahmana gets relieved of Rishiranam. By performing Shrautasmartha Karmas, a Brahmana gets relieved from Devaranam. By performing all the Pitru Karmas and by getting children, he gets relieved from Pitruanam. And only when a Brahmana gets relieved from all of these three debts, he is eligible for moksha. So again, there is a shloka in Manusmriti which says that a Brahmana has to perform all of these Vaidika karmas. He has to perform Vedadhyayanam. He has to perform Shrauta Smartha Karma Anushthanam. He has to perform he has to perform all the Pitru Karmas. And then Mano Moksha Niveshayet. And then there is also a passage which says Anadhitya Khilan Vedana Anishtvaiva Khilan Surana Anutpadya Sutan Vipraha Nasanyasitumarhati. Without studying the Vedas, that is without getting relief from the Rishirinam, Anishtvaiva Akhilan Suran, without performing Shrauta Karmas and getting relief from Devaranam, Anutpadya Sutana, without begetting children and without performing the Pitru Karmas, Nasanyasita Marhati, a Brahmana is not eligible to take up sannyasa, because sannyasa, the ashrama, is the one which gives us moksha. So Guruvamsha Kavyam says that, describes Shivaguru Dikshitar, Nirmukto Vratakarana Dranadrishinam. Again, Shivaguru was relieved from Rishiranam. And then he was also relieved from all the Devaranam by performing all the Vaidika karmas. But he did not get relief from Pitruanam. And Sachinta Manasi Sadasya Sannivishta. And that thought kept pestering him all the time. In the same way, the same thought kept pestering the father of Srimad Appaya Dikshitendra Shri Rangaraja Dhvari. And so he went to the temple of his Kuladevata, Shri Margabandhu Swami. So the temple of Margabandhu Swami is located in a kshetram known as Tiruvirinchipuram, which is located very close to Adayapala Magraharam. So he goes to the temple of Margabandhu Swami, and long ago in the place of Tiruvirinchipuram, Lord Brahma took birth in the form of a human being because of a curse. So he had a curse which made him take birth as a human being in the earthly planet. So this took place in some bygone yuga, and he was born in a family of Brahmanas who were great Shiva Bhaktas. He lost his father at a very young age, and the puja kainkaryam of that temple was his family, right? So when his father was no more, and when he was a very young boy of 4 or 5 years, all the relatives of this young boy tried to grab the position of being the temple archakas in Margabandhu Swami's temple. So to save this young boy, the Lord appeared himself in the form of a very old Brahmana, and he performed Upanayanam for him, Upanayanam and Brahmopadesham for him. and with being initiated by the Lord himself, he returns back to the Agraharam, and all the Brahmanas allow him to perform puja, and he performs puja to Margabandhu Swami. And because he was extremely small in size, he was unable to perform Abhishekam to the Lord's Murti. And he began to cry because he was unable to do Abhishekam to the Lord. Out of mercy for his devotee, the Lord lowered his head. And by that, the little boy was able to perform Abhishekam and Kainkaryam and Puja to the Murti of Bhagavan. And in that Kshetram, Sri Rangaraja Dikshitar and his wife performed Tapasya and Aradharam to Margabandhu Swami. And on one final day, when the Lord was very happy with his Aradhanam, he spoke to him as a disembodied voice, as Ashariri Vani. And he said, "I am extremely happy with your tapascharya. So you go to Chidambaram Kshetram, and there in the form of Nataraja, you worship me. And in the Chidambaram Kshetram, in the form of Nataraja, I will give you all that you desire for." And Rangaraja Dhvari felt very happy, and he left for Chidambaram Kshetram immediately. He stayed in Chidambaram for around 5 to 6 years and performed Aradhanam to Nataraja Swami. And one day morning, when he had gone to the temple of Nataraja to see the Lord appeared himself in the form of a Tillai Dikshita. He came to him, he appeared with a golden vessel which was filled with Jambu Phalasparasam, the juice of Jambu fruit, and giving the Jambu Phalasparasam to him, to Rangaraja Dhvari, he said, "Give this prasadam to your wife, and with my blessings, you will get one son who will be an incarnation of my own self, who will be an Amshavataram of my own self. And after that, another son and a daughter will be born to you." Saying this, the Tillai Dikshitar disappeared from sight. On seeing this, Rangaraja Dhvari felt very happy. He was so excited to see this. He went home immediately and he gave the Jambunada Chashakam. So the Jambunada Chashakam is the golden vessel which was filled with Jambu Phalasvarasam. So he handed over the Varna Patram to his wife. And he narrated all that took place in the Nataraja's temple. With great joy, his Dharmapatni consumed the prasadam. And within 10 months, a son was born to them. And he was named as Vinayaka Subramanya Sharma. And this Vinayaka Subramanya Sharma is none other than our Srimad Appaya Dikshitendra. And Sri Mannargudi Raju Shastri says in his Dikshitendra, says in one of his works, so he says that Vikrame Bhutalam Prapya Vijaye Svargamayayuhu. Dikshitendra appeared in the Bhutalam, in the earthly planet, in the year Vikrama, and he disappeared from this earthly planet in the year of Vijayam. So the Vikrama Samvatsaram is 1520 CE, Vijaya Samvatsaram is 1593 CE. And Shivananda Yogindra gives the date of Dikshitendra's birth. So the year of Dikshitendra's birth with Shivananda Yogindra is birth. So that has been proved wrong by Y. Mahalinga Shastri, who was the grandfather of Sri Mannargudi Raju Shastri. So Shivananda Yogindra says, "Veena Tattvajna Sankhyala Sitakalisama Bhakpramati Chavarshe." And then Kanyama says, so the Pramati Chavarsham which Shivananda Yogindra says, so that is why Mahalinga Shastri says that the mention of that year is wrong. But Kanya Masam Krishna Paksha Prathama is accepted by everyone. So that is being celebrated by us, all of us, as Dikshitendra Jayanti. So Dikshitendra was born. And after Dikshitendra was born, another son was born, and he was Achan Dikshitar. And this Achan Dikshitar was the grandfather of Nilakantha Dikshitar of Palamade. So after Achan Dikshitar, they had a daughter who was named as Jnanambika. And Jnanambika had two sons. The elder one was Mosur Suryanarayana Dikshitar, and the younger one was Mosur Samarapungava Dikshitar. And this Samarapungava Dikshitar was the grandfather of the celebrated Sri Gangadhara Vajapeyaji. Gangadhara Vajpayeeyaji was the guru of the celebrated Sri Bhaskararaya Dikshita, who was the commentator of Vala, who wrote Bhashyam on Dalita Sahasranama Stotram. So they had three children. Rangaraja Dikshita had three children. The eldest was Srimad Appayya Dikshitendra. The youngest, the second son was Achan Dikshita. And the third was Jnanambika. Jnanambika got married to a Brahmana belonging to the Vadhula Gotra. And then when Dikshitendra was about 5 years, when he was 5 years old, so when he was about 4 years old, Rangaraja Dikshita sent him to the Patshala of Sri Guru Ramakavi to study Sanskrit Sahityam, Natakam and Alankaram. So by the age of 5, Appayya Dikshitendra had mastered the script of many languages, and he could also speak many languages. He mastered Sanskrit Sahityam, he studied all the Kavyams, he studied Natakam and Alankarams by the age of 5. So Dikshitendra studied in a place known as Mullandram under Sri Guru Ramakavi. Swaminathan sir?
Yeah.
Could you please show the place of Mullandram?
Yeah.
So this is the place where Dikshitendra studied Sanskrit Sahityam. This is known as Mullandram. So this is the Mullandram is located very close to Adaipalam Agraharam. And this is the place where the celebrated Arunagirinath was also born. And today this place lies in ruins. And it is a matter of great regret that it lies in such a state today. And one of the greatest Sanskrit scholars of early modern era. So he had, Dikshitendra had produced innumerable Sanskrit works. And it is a matter of great regret that it lies in such a condition today. And I'd like to bring this to the notice of all Astikas and all the Sanskrit enthusiasts. So it is my prayer and hope that this place gets reclaimed and preserved as a heritage site. So this is the place where Dikshitendra studied Sanskrit Sahitya. So after finishing Sanskrit Sahityam, his father performed Upanayanam for him. And after that, he taught, Rangarajadwari himself taught Samavedam to him. So again, Prahim Sashadangam Adhyapayamasuho Seshkevi Subramanya Shastra. So he taught the Veda along with the six Vedangas. So that is how in olden days, people used to study Vedas. So it is not Kevala Veda Dhyanam, it's not Veda Dhyanam without the study of Vedangas. So for 6 months they used to study the Vedas, and for 6 months they used to study the Vedangas. So Trahim Sashadangam Adhyapayamasuhu. And then over time, after that even Rangaraja Dikshita also taught him Purva Mimamsa and Vedanta Shastram. So everywhere in all of his works, Appayya Dikshitendra refers to Sri Rangarajadhvari as his guru. And after a few years, Rangaraja Dikshitendra passed away. And then Dikshitendra came under the patronage of the king of Velu, Sri Chinnabomma Nayaka. And in the meantime, there was another great Agnihotri living in an Agraharam known as Shura Samudram in Kanchipuram. He was known as Srinivasa Dikshita or Ratnaketa Srinivasa Dikshita. So he was patronized by another Nayaka king who was named as Shurappa Nayaka. So he got the name Ratnaketa Dikshita because of two reasons. So the first reason was because he composed a very beautiful poetry in Sanskrit, describing the beauty of sun and moon and the beauty of the mountains that lie in the east and the mountains that lie in the west. And then he used the word Ratnaketa, and because of that, Shurappa Nayaka Maharaja gave him the name Ratnaketa. And this Ratnaketa Dikshita was a very great Devi Upasaka. He was a very great devotee of Kamakshi Devi, and he was a Devi Upasaka. So he was the grandson of Sri Krishna Bhattaraka and Sri Bhava Swami. And once upon a time, when he was under the patronage of King Chandrasekhara. So in the court sabha, the Raja asked him, what was the tithi today? So it was actually Amavasya, that was not Purnima. By mistake, he told that today's tithi is Purnima. So the Raja laughed at him, saying it is not Amavasya, not Purnima. And then Srinivasaji Ekshwar told that he could prove that it is Purnima today. And in the evening, while performing the Sayam Sandhya Vandanam, he meditated upon Chandrakaladhaya Bhava, Devi in the form of Chandrakaladharini. And pleased with his devotion, Kamakshi Devi appeared herself and handed over her tatankam to him. And she told him that whenever he wishes, he could throw it against the sky. And when the tatankam flies against the sky, so tatankam means earring, so it will turn into a moon. So saying this, the Devi disappeared from sight. Ratnakheta Dikshita, Srinivasa Dikshita returns to the king, and in the front of all who had assembled there, he threw the Devi's tatankam against the sky, and the tatankam turned into a moon, and the Raja was extremely happy with that, and he ascended Srinivasa Dikshita on a golden throne, and he showered him, he performed Abhishekam to him with a lot of ratnams. అంటే శివానంద యోగీంద్రాసస్ తతప్రభృతి రత్నఖేట కవిరాడితి ప్రథామ్. ఫ్రమ్ దెన్ ఆన్వర్డ్స్ శ్రీనివాస దీక్షిత కేమ్ టు బి నోన్ యాజ్ రత్నఖేట దీక్షిత. అండ్ వన్స్ ఇన్ అ ఫ్యూ కాశీ పండితాస్, సమ్ యంగ్ స్కాలర్స్ ఫ్రమ్ కాశీ, దే వాంటెడ్ టు డిఫీట్ రత్నఖేట దీక్షిత ఇన్ అ వాక్యార్థ విద్వత్ సభ. Ratnakheta Dikshita was a very great scholar in all the Shastras, in Nyayam, Vyakaranam, Purva Mimamsa and Vedantam. So some scholars, some young boys wanted to defeat him in a Vakyartha Vidvat Sabha. So they came to his house early in the morning. And at that time, Ratnakheta Dikshita's wife, so she had come outside early in the morning to sprinkle Gomayambu Jalam outside their house yard. And then they express their desire to engage in a vakyartham with Ratnakheta Dikshita in a somewhat arrogant tone. So Dikshita's wife, she started sprinkling water and she told them, she spoke a very beautiful shloka. So this is the shloka. Vipashchitama paschimetha Ratnakheta Dikshita sapatnajitya yatnato vivadake limagate. Rihaspati prajalpati prasatpati kvasarparat kadana no natanana chaturmukhascha durmukha. So it means vipaschitama paschime. So vipaschit means great scholars. Apaschime means a very great scholar. So Ratnakheta Dikshita was a very great person among the scholars themselves. So when he enters an assembly, vipaschitama paschime tha Ratnakheta Dikshita. And then sapatnajitya yatnato vivadake limagase. So when he comes for a vakyartham, and then she says, Brihaspati prajalpati, even Brihaspati Deva starts blabbering. Brihaspati prajalpati, and then prasarpati kvasarparat, even sarparat means adishesha, shesha deva. Even he starts fleeing the place. And then Shadanano Natananaha, even Subramanya Deva, so he keeps his head lower. Shadanano Natanana Shaturmukhascha Durmukhaha. And then even the face of Chaturanana, even the face of Brahma becomes a little bit back. So this is what she said, and this is not a Devata Avahel, so this is not meant for making fun of the Devatas. So a beautiful alankaram has been employed here. So it's not meant for making fun of the Devatas. So it's not a literal meaning that is being given here by the Ratnakheta Dikshita's wife. So after hearing this, so the young scholars felt that even she has such a great panditium. So even if she has such a great panditium, what would be the panditium of Ratnakheta Dikshita? So being ashamed of it, all the young scholars went away. And this Ratnakheta Dikshita, so once he wanted to, so No, he heard the glories of Appaya Dikshitendra, young Vinayaka Subramanya Sharma. On hearing it, he wanted to engage in a Vakyartha Vidvat Sadas with him and defeat him in a Sabha. So he performed Aradhanam to Kamakshi Devi. So in one Navaratri, he performed elaborate puja. And at the end of the puja, Kamakshi Devi appeared herself. And she said, you ask me for whatever boon you want and I shall grant you. And when Ratnaketa Dikshitar asked what he wanted for, Kamakshi Devi said, you cannot defeat Dikshitendra in a Vakyartham. You can only defeat human beings in a Vidvat Sabha. Because Dikshitendra is Parameshwara himself. You can never defeat him in a Vakyartha Vidvat Sabha. So I cannot grant you that boon. So instead, you give away your daughter to him. So in that way, you can prove yourself superior to Dikshitendra. So because a son-in-law falls at the feet of father-in-law while doing Sashtanga Namaskarams. So in that way, Kamakshi Devi told him that he could prove himself as superior to Dikshitendra. Ratnaketa Dikshitar felt very happy. And as per Devi's instructions, he left for the place where Dikshitendra would reside. And in the meantime, Ekamranath himself appeared in Dikshitendra's dream and he told him that a great Brahmana named Ratnaketa Dikshitar is going to give away his daughter to him. And then he said, you go to Kanchipuram and there he will come and meet you. And after seeing you, he will give away his daughter to you. And as ordained by Kamakshi Devi and Ekamreshwara, so with the sankalpa of Kamakshi Devi and Ekamranatha, Ratnaketa Dikshitar came to meet Vinayaka Subramanya Sharma. And then the marriage was arranged. And the marriage ceremony took place in a very grand manner. And then from Vinayaka Subramanya Sharma, he became Appaya Dikshitar. So because the word Dikshitar means only Grihastha Brahmana is known as Dikshitar. Brahmacharis are not known as Dikshitar. Brahmacharis don't get the title Dikshitar. So he married the daughter of Nityagnihotri, Sri Ratnaketa Dikshitar, and he left for Adayappalam. In Adayappalam, again K.V. Subramanya Shastrigal says that he was engaged in the performance of all the Vaidika karmas. And he says, Panchaya Jnanushthana Nirataha Yathavad Anushthita Ashtakadi Sapta Pakaya Jnasamsthaha Samacharita Jnadheyadi Sapta Havirya Jnasamsthaha. So it means Sapta Pakaya Sapta Panchaya Jnanushthana Nirataha. So there are 5 yajnams which a Brahmana is expected to perform. Deva Yajnam, and then Bhuta Yajnam, Manushya Yajnam, Bhuta Yajnam, and then Brahma Yajnam, Deva Yajnam, Rishi Yajnam, Manushya Yajnam, Bhuta Yajnam, and Brahma Yajnam. So these 5 Yajnams, and then Yathavata Anushthita. So Yathavata in the prescribed manner, Anushthita Ashtakadi Sapta Paka Yajna Samsthaha. So there are 8 Paka Yajnas. So there is Ashtakam, and then Parvanam, Shraddham, and then Agrahayani, and then Chaitri, Ashvayu. So all of these are Sapta Paka Yajnams. And then Yathavad Anushthita, Samacharita Agnyadheyadi, Sapta Havir Yajna Samsthaha. So Agnyadhanam is initiation into the path of Shrautam. Agnyadhanam is number 1. And then Agnihotram is number 2, Darshapurna Masam, Chaturmasam is number 4, and then Agrayanam is number 5, and then Nirudhapashubandham, and then the 7th one is Sautramani. And by performing all these, so Swagrame Ushitvasa, he lived in his own gramam of Adayappalam, and then he was performed, he worshipped Yajneshwara, Yajneshwaramayajanta. And then once again, Dikshitendra says, and then K.V. Subramanya Shastrigal says, in this way, Dikshitendra had Brahmanas who resembled Vasishtha Maharshi in prowess. So they were as meticulous as Vasishtha Maharshi in performing the Shrauta Karmas. They were highly experts in performing Shrauta Karmas. And under such Brahmanas, he took his training in the performance of Shrautam. So just like Veda Dhyanam is different, Shastra Dhyanam, or study of Shastras is different, Sanskrita Sahityam Adhyayanam is different, Shrauta Karmas, Shrauta Dhyanam is also different from these. So he had his Shrauta Dhyanam under Brahmanas who were great experts in the performance of Shrauta Karmas. And then he uses the word Nirbhyudhartvijyadhuraha. So it means he finished completing his internship under such Brahmanas. And then once again, I think it's already time, we still have 15 minutes left. So in this way, Dikshitendra performed a yajnam known as Jyotishtomam. After performing Jyotishtomam, he performed a yajnam known as Vajapayam. And during the Vajapayi yajnam which he performed in Kanchipuram, so there is a procedure known as Pashusamgnyapanam. And after that procedure was over, the Gandharvas, Kinnaras and Charanas appeared themselves in person in his Yagashala. And this was a very great sight for all those who were present in the Yagashala. So after this, so there is something known as Avabhrita Karma. So this the Avabhrita Karma or Avabhrita Snanam marks the end of any yajnam. So there was one king known as Nrisimha Bhupala Varma, who was ruling Tanjavur, who was also a Nayak Maharaja. He performed the Shweta Chhatradharanam for Dikshitendra. So he held the royal umbrella and he walked Dikshitendra towards the pond where the Avabhrita Snanam would be performed. And the entire team of Brahmanas who took part in the yajnam, all of them had their Snanam along with Dikshitendra. So the Avabhrita Karma, the Avabhrita Snanam was a very great festival. And after the Avabhrita Snanam was performed, Dikshitendra's glory spread very far and wide. And after performing the Vajapayam in Kanchipuram, he erected a Vijayastambham in Sarvatirtha Pushkarani. Many kings took part in Dikshitendra's Vajapaya Yajnam, and only one king did not take part, and he was Chinnabamma Maharaja of Velu. And after hearing the glories of Dikshitendra, he felt very bad that he did not take part in Dikshitendra's Vajapaya Yajnam. Because the Raja's father had, been patronizing Dikshitendra's father and grandfather. Because he came under the wrong influence, Chinnabamma Raja did not patronize Dikshitendra initially. So he felt very bad for the sin that he had committed. So he did not patronize the great Mahatma. So he felt very bad and he met Dikshitendra in person. And he begged Dikshitendra for forgiveness. And after Dikshitendra forgave him, he ordered for a golden palanquin. And in a golden palanquin, he took Dikshitendra from Adayapalam to Velu. And when Dikshitendra shifted his residence from Adayapalam to Velu, he became an Asthana Pandita in the Raja's court in Velu. And when during his stay in Velu, so many incidents took place. So there were some controversies between some scholars in that Rajya Sabha and Dikshitendra. And they kept plotting many ways to even assassinate Dikshitendra. And none of those plans worked. And once, when Dikshitendra had gone to Kanchi, he was invited to Kanchipuram by a group of Sri Vaishnava Brahmanas. And the drama of Swami Vedanta Deshikar was being played, Sankalpa Suryodaya Natakam. And when the drama was being played, so there is a shloka that appears in the Natakam, Yatishvara Saraswati Surabhitashayanam Satam. So while reciting that shloka, So the actor was reciting that shloka and he was turning towards a different side. So it means Yatishwara Saraswati means the Yatishwara is Ramanujachar, Surabhita Ashayanam Satam. So those great scholars who follow Ramanujacharya, Vahami Charanam Bhujam Pranatishailina Maulina, and then I bow down to their lotus feet with my head bowed down, and then Tadanya Mata Durmata Dvalita Teja Samvadinam, and then and to the others who follow other philosophies, and then he says, I place my left foot and while saying the fourth padam, Shirasunihitamaya Padama Dakshinal Lakshyatam. So when Adakshina means left, Dakshinam means right, Adakshinam is left. And while saying the fourth padam of the shloka, he came towards the side of Dikshitendra, and facing Dikshitendra, he placed his he raised his left leg. And even K.V. Subramanya Shastrigal says that even some Sri Vaishnava hagiographies record this incident. Such an insult was done, Dikshitendra felt very bad, and he did not react to them in the place where the drama was being enacted. He came back home with a very heavy heart, and after that he took his pen and then he started engaging in the battle against Shivadvaisam. So again, one great scholar says that though Dikshitendra was an exponent of his own school of thought, and he wrote words refuting other philosophies as untenable or unacceptable. Again, but he was not a sectarian by God, by conviction. So he says, and he was greatly devoted to Lord Vishnu, just like he was devoted to Lord Shiva. So when controversy was forced upon him by people who were bent upon polemics in religion or polemics, so they could see in him a foeman who was more than mighty of their steel. So, but the Dikshitendra did not flinch from battle when narrow sectarianism reared its head. So this is what happened in that at that time. And he came back home, and when he was sleeping, he was just thinking of how he could reform the society, because Shivadvesham is also unhealthy. Vishnu Dvesham by Shiva Bhaktas and Shiva Dvesham by Vishnu Bhaktas, both of these are unhealthy in the society. So when he was sleeping, Parameshwara himself appeared in his dream, and he asked him to write a commentary upon Srikantha Shivacharya's Brahma Sutra Bhashyam, explaining it in detail. And when he woke up, so he was, the Lord appeared himself, himself in Dikshitendra's dream in the form of Chinnabhama Raja. So the next day morning when Dikshitendra woke up, and then when he went to the Raja Sabha after performing all his anushtanams and all that, the very first thing that Chinnabhama Raja requested him was, O Swami, please write a commentary upon the Brahma Sutra Bhashyam of Shiva, Srikanthacharya. So by you writing a detailed commentary on it, the Pandita Loka, so the society of scholars, so it has to be blessed by you. So after hearing this from Chinnabhama Raja, Dikshitendra wrote a detailed commentary on Srikanthacharya's Brahma Sutra Bhashyam, and this is known as Shivarthamani Deepika. So this is it's a very beautiful grantham. So it's a recondite text in Vedanta. So only those scholars who have studied Vyakarana Shastram in great detail, so only they can understand, they can enter into the study of Shivarkamani Deepika. Only those scholars who have an Asadharana Panditim, not just a decent knowledge of Nyaya Shastram, but an Asadharana Panditim in Nyaya Shastram, only they can delve into Shivarkamani Deepika. Only those scholars who have an Asadharana Panditim in Purva Mimamsa, not just a decent knowledge of Purva Mimamsa Shastra, can enter into the study of Shivarkamani Deepika. And it doesn't just end there. They should also have studied Vedanta Shastram in great depth, so they should also have an asadharana panditiyam in Vedanta Shastram. Only then they can enter into the study of Shiva Arkamani Deepika. And A.V. Subhagavu, Gopalacharya says that the kind of kaikaryam which Vachaspati Mishra offered to the Shankaracharya Sampradayam by writing a tika on Adishankara Bhagavatpada Sutra Bhashyam, the kind of kaikaryam which Sudarshanacharya offered to the Sri Vaishnava Sampradayam by writing a commentary on Ramanujacharya's Sutra Bhashyam, and the kind of service offered by Jayatirthacharya to Madhva Sampradayam by writing a very elaborate commentary on Madhvacharya's Brahma Sutra Bhashyam, that kind of service was done by Srimad Appaya Dikshitendra to the Shivadvaita Vedanta. So Srikanthacharya Sampradayam, by writing a commentary on his Brahma Sutra Bhashyam. And then Dikshitendra says that Bhashyame tadanagham vibhrandvati svapna jagaranayo samam vibhude, both in my dream state as well as in my jagrata svapnavastha as well as in jagrata avastha, svapna jagaranayo samam vibhu. So the Lord has instructed me to write this commentary both in my sleep as well as in my wakeful state. Chinnabhumman ruparupa bhrat svayam, so by taking the form of Chinnabhumma Raja, mamya yungta mahilardha vigraha, so the Lord has appointed me in this task. Mahilardha vigraha, mahila is woman, devi. So mahilardha vigraha is Ardhanarishwara or Lord Parameshwara himself. So after Dikshitendra wrote Shiva Arkamani Deepika, Chinnabhumma Raja, so he ascended him on a golden throne, and he performed the Swarna Abhishekam to him. So he performed Abhishekam to him with golden coins. And then Dikshitendra left for Adayapalam, and he erected a temple for Shiva known as Kalakantheshwara Alayam. He erected a temple for Vishnu known as Varadaraja Alayam. And there is a very beautiful inscription in Kalakantheshwara temple on the walls of Adayapalam which says, Swasti Shri Shakabdam Sella Nindra Chitrabhanu Varsham Swami Kalakantheshwara Ruda Kovilile Shri Kantha Bhashyam Ainyura Vidvam Saruk Padipika Adukki Shivarka Mani Deepike Vyakhyana Mumpanni Adukki Pin Velur Chinnabhumanayakar Kayile Kanaka Abhishekamum Mumpanni Vichukkonda. So this is the inscription that is, you could see in Adayapalam. Shivarkamani Swarnabhishekamum Panni Vichukkonda Adukku Pin Shivarkamani Deepikai Ainyura Vidvamsarukku Padippikka Suvarnangalum Agraharangalum Padippichu Prithivirajamum Panni Vichu Kalpataru Parimala Mudalana Nooru Prabandham Pannina Appaya Deekshitarodu Kriti Inda Shivalayam Shubhamastu. So it says, Swasti Shri Shakabdam Ayrati Ayyuti Nalukumen. So the Chitrabhanu Varsham, so in the year of Chitrabhanu, Swami Kalakantheshwara Ruda Kovilile, the temple of Kalakantheshwara, Shri Kantha Bhashyam, Brahma Sutra Bhashyam of Shri Kanthacharya, Ainyura Vidvamsaruk Padipika, Dikshitendra taught the Bhashyam of Shri Kanthacharya to 500 scholars. Ainyura Vidvamsaruk Padipika, the Shivarkamani Deepika Vyakhyanamum Panni. He also wrote a commentary known as Shivarkamani Deepika on it. Shivarkamani Deepika Vyakhyanamum Panni. And Velur Chinnabhumanayakar Kayile Kanakabhishekamum Panni Vichukonda. And he got it. He was showered with gold by the Raja. And then he taught Shivarkamani Deepika to 500 Vidwans. He also received a lot of gold as Danam from the Raja. He received many agraharams as Danam from the Raja. And in those agraharams, he hosted 500 disciples of him. And he taught Brahma Sutra Bhashyam to those 500 disciples. And then he says, Appaya Dikshitar Sadase Ervai, Arunagiri Dikshitar Sadase Ervai, Vishwajit Appaya Dikshitar Sadase Ervai, Umamaheshwara Dikshitar Sadase Ervai, Yagneshwara Dikshtar Sada Sairbai, Marutu Alan Lakshan Sada Sairbai. So this is a very beautiful inscription. You could see this in the Adaipalam Agraharam, the walls of Adaipalam. And with this, I am concluding today's speech. And in tomorrow's speech, we will see the Tirthayatras which Adikshitendra undertook and the other Leelas that took place in his life. His meeting of Bhattoji Dikshitar in Chidambaram, the famous grammarian, the Vyakarana Vidwan Bhattoji Dikshitar in Chidambaram, and the celebrated Sanyasi from Maharashtra, Nrisimhasharma Swamigal, who came to meet him in Chidambaram, and many other Leelas, and then until the Sayujya Prapti. And Dikshitendra spent his last years in Chidambaram Kshetram. And during his final days, he spent in the Sannidhi of Nataraja. And he merged with the deity of Nataraja himself. So with this, I would like to conclude. So today's Bhashanam is over. And tomorrow, we will see the rest of Dikshitendra Vijay.
Madlokavatamsat varivararachittaha ये प्रबंधा प्रथन्ते देशे देशे विदुष्मत्यदि मुष्टभिर्मोह संदोह वृन्दाः तेषामर्थं यथावत् कतिचन कृतिनः सर्वतन्त्रैकवेद्यम् धन्याः संविद्रते तान् शरणयतु जनो घोरसंसारभीरुः मूर्धन्यत्वेन मीमां सकवरनिकरे ये स्तुताः कौस्तुभेऽपि श्रीमन्तो यत् प्रबन्धाः शतमिह विदुषां वृन्दमानन्दयन्ति अन्यानाघातयुक्तिप्रचयघटनया ध्वंसितं मध्वतन्त्रं नानोदाहारयुक्ताः त्रिविधविधिभिदा स्फुटं ज्ञापितानः आत्मज्ञानं विमुक्तेः गमकमिति तदभ्यर्थिनां सत्यकीनां सद्यो मुक्तेरवाप्त्यै यरचि परिमलोन्याय रक्षामणिश्च केषाञ्चित् प्रेम लक्ष्मीपतिसदनगतौ वीक्ष्य तल्लक्ष्मणार्याद्याहूतव्यञ्जिका सापि अकथिनयमयूखादिमाला विशाला माध्वे तन्त्रेऽपि तिष्ठन् मधुमथन सदा राधनोद्धूतपुण्यैः शुद्धात्मा श्रद्दधीतश्रुतिमकुतगते ब्रह्मणि स्वात्मभूते इत्यालोच्य स्वयं तद्विहितमपि मतुं रक्षितुं ग्रन्थभेदे माध्वानाय्यै प्रणीता परमहितकरी न्यायमुक्तावली सा येषां पादाब्जरेणु स्मरणमलमघौघस्य विध्वस्तयेन पुण्यौघस्योपचित्यै न तदुभयजुषाम् उच्चिदन्यध्यपेक्ष्यम् प्रायो लोकोपकार प्रबलित मनस स्वान्वये जन्म भाजम् ते मां रक्षन्तु भीतं भवदवदहनात् संप्रसाद्याम्बिकेशम् यत्प्रोचे शम्भुभक्तिं विघटयितुमलं तत्त्वमुक्ता कलापे प्रत्युचे तच्छ्रुतीनां दययुपविवृते शिवकर्णामृतादौ श्रीकण्ठार्योक्तिमूलम् परम परमतमपि नोन्मूलितं तत्प्रभावात् कोऽन्यशक्तो भुवि स्यात् महिकुलतिलकात् सर्वलोकोपकृत्यै सार्वज्ञं वीक्ष्य येषां प्रथितकविवरैः सार्वभूमैः शशंसे येषामाशीर्भिराभूत् अखिलकुशलथाङ्गीलकण्ठाध्वरीन्द्रः येषां तादात्मिकेभ्यः किल सकलकलाबल्लभत्वं बुधेभ्यः सर्वेभ्योऽभ्यर्हितं प्राक् अभवदिति समाकर्ष्णये वर्णये किं प्रबन्धशतनिर्मितिः प्रथितमग्निहोत्रादिकं श्रुतप्रवचनादयश्चितजनावनार्थं प्रभोः सभां प्रतिगतागतं समुदितं मखीन्द्रेषु नः कियत्यलसता सतामपि ततः परेषां भुवि शंकर भगवत्पादाचार्यास्त्वद्वैतमार्गमिव ये प्रत्यतिष्ठिपन् भुवि शिवभक्तिपथं कथं न ते वन्द्याः नवरत्नमालिकैषा महिराजचरित्रमञ्जुमञ्जूषा दुरितौघतिमिरभूषा योषार्धतनोस्तनोतु परितोषम् श्रीमदप्पय्य दीक्षितेन्द्र परब्रह्मणे नमः हर नमः पार्वती पतये हर हर महादेव। श्रीकान्तो मातुलो यस्य जननी सर्वमंगला जनकशंकरो देवः तं वन्दे कुञ्जरानन्दं श्यामवल्ली समालीढं विरिञ्चिपुरभास्वरं मार्गबन्ध्वाह्वयं तेजः तनोतु विमलां धियं इदं चरंगं त्यजतामिहांगं न विद्यतेऽङ्गं यदि वास्तु चांगं पाणौ रथांगं शयने भुजंगं याने विहंगं चरणे च गांगं कावेरी तटशोधिरंगनगरप्ताभागजम्बूतरुक्तान्तोद्यन्मणिसद्मनिस्थितमधः जम्बूतरोस्थायिनः दूतेभार्चितरंगनाथवरदं भक्त्याखिलांडेश्वरी पूजानिर्मितसज्जलाकृतिधरं श्रीजम्बुनाथं भजे श्रुतिस्मृतिपुराणानाम् आलयं करुणालयं नमामि भगवत्पादं शंकरं लोकशंकरं अप्पय्य दीक्षितेन्द्रान् अशेष विद्यागुरूनहं वन्दे यत्कृतिबोधाबोधौ विद्वद् विद्वद्विभाजकोपाधि।
माय हंबल ओबेसेंस टू श्री शारदाम्बा ऑफ श्रृंगेरी। My humble obeisance to Sri Adi Shankara Bhagavat Pada and Srimad Appaiya Dikshitendra. My humble obeisance to the Jagat Guru Shankara Acharya of Shringeri, Paramhamsa Parivrajamekara Bharati Swamigal. On the third and the last day of our 500th year of Dikshitendra Jayanti celebration, I thank the Shringeri Guru Bandhava team and the Tattva Loka team for organizing this event. And I thank the administrator of Sringeri Matham Srirangam for hosting my talk in the temple of Sri Shankara Gurukulam of Srirangam. In yesterday's talk, I narrated the tale of Dikshitendra's writing Shivarkamani Deepika. Today, I'll be narrating the remaining portions from Dikshitendra Vijayam. While explaining the fact that the Supreme Being is the impersonal Brahman which is devoid of all dualities and attributes, and that is the consensus of the Brahma Sutras and Upanishads and all of the Vedic scriptures, Dikshitendra makes a point, an important point that is very vital for us to grasp. And he says that the cultivation of Nirvishesha Jnanam is possible only by the blessings of Parameshwara. So he says this in his commentary to Shivarkamani Deepika, Shrikanthacharya's Brahma Sutra Bhashya. So we being followers of Adi Shankara Bhagavat Pada, why should we take pride in Dikshitendra writing a commentary to a Shivacharya's Brahma Sutra Bhashya? The reason lies here. In the beginning of Shrikanthacharya's Brahma Sutra Bhashya's commentary, Dikshitendra proclaims the glories of Advaita Vedanta and of Adi Shankara Bhagavat Pada's matam. He says the following. He says that the quintessence of all the Vedic scriptures is Advaita alone. So the following two shlokas of Dikshitendra written in the beginning of Shivarkam and Deepika should be engraved in words of gold and should be etched in heart in the hearts of all the followers of Adi Shankara Bhagavat Pada. And these are the two shlokas. Yadyapyadvaita eva shruti shikhara giramadamanam chanishtha sakam sarvaih puranaih smritinikara mahabharatadi prabandhaih tatraiva brahmasutranyapi cha vimrishatam bhanti vishranti manti ratnairacharya ratnair apipari jugrihe shankaradhyai tadeva tathapyanugrahadeva tarunendu shikhamaneh advaita vasana pumsam avirbhavati nanyatha yadyapi although Advaita even in the philosophy of Advaita alone, Shruti Shikhara Giram Nishtha. So the word Nishtha means Tatparata, means the ultimate purpose. So the Shruti Shikhara means the Upanishads. Shruti Shikhara Ghihi means the passages or vakyams of Upanishads. So all the passages, the ultimate purpose of all the Upanishads lies in Advaita Vedanta. Shruti Shikhara Giram, and then Agamanam, the word Agama means Vedas, Agamanam Chanishtha, in Sakam Sarvaih Puranaihi, Sakam along with Sarvaihi Puranaihi, all the Puranas, the Mahapuranas, the Upapuranas, Sakam Sarvaih Puranaihi, and then Smritinikara Mahabharatadi Prabandhaihi. Smritinam Nikaraha is Smritinikaraha. Nikaraha means Samuhaha or group. The Smriti group of texts, along with the Smriti group of texts, and along with the compositions like Mahabharatam and Valmiki Ramayana and the Itihasas. So along with these, the Nishtha of all the Upanishads and the Vedas lies in Advaita philosophy alone. And then he says, Tatraiva Brahmasutran Yapicha Vimrishatam Bhanti Vishranti Manti. Tatraiva means Tasmin Advaita Eva. So in that Advaita philosophy alone, so the word Eva, the word eva has got many different meanings. And vyavachheda means to rule out something. The word vyavachheda is one meaning of the word eva. There are many different, the three different ways in which the word eva is used in vyavachheda artham. So when we divide it further, so it could be associated with visheshyam or the noun. It could be associated with visheshanam or adjective. It could be associated with kriya or verb. So we say it as Visheshya Sangatam or Visheshada Sangatam or Kriya Sangatam. Here in this context, the word Eva is Visheshya Sangatam. Visheshyam or the noun here is Advaita, the word Advaita. So again, once again, the further meaning of this is Anyonya Vyavachedaha. So the further meaning of the Vyavachedam here is to rule out all other entities, the other entities that are on par with the noun. So the other entities here, so Advaitam is Visheshyam here. The other entities are Dvaita Vishishta, Dvaita, the philosophies. So he says that. So Advaita alone is the supreme, says Dikshitendra in Shrikanthacharya, commentary on Shrikanthacharya's Brahma Sutra Bhashya. And then he says, Tatraiva Brahma Sutranyapi, even the Brahma Sutras, the Vedanta Sutras written by Vyasacharya, Vishranti Manti Bhanti. So they appear to be rooted in that philosophy alone. To those who study them with astute analysis, Vimrishita means those who study with astute analysis. And then he says, Pratnaihi Acharya Ratnaihi. Pratnaihi means ancient, by the Acharyas of old. Acharya Ratnaihi, gem of Acharyas like Adi Shankara Bhagavat Pada. That philosophy alone has been accepted as the ultimate truth. Apipari jagrihe shankaradhyai tadeva. In spite of all that, tathapi, in spite of all that, although suspashtataya, everything is clear that the quintessence of all the Vedic scriptures is Advaita, tathapi, anugrahadeva, tarunendu shikhamana, it's only by the mercy of tarunendu shikhamani, Lord Parameshwara, who holds crescent moon on his head, it's only by his mercy, Advaita Vasana Pumsam Avirbhavati. A taste in Advaita arises in the hearts of men only by the mercy of the Supreme Parameshwara, Nanyatha, not otherwise, he says in his commentary Shivarkamani Deepika. So it's a matter of pride for all of us that Dikshitendra proclaims loudly the glories of Advaita Vedanta and of Adishankara Bhagavatpada in Shivarkamani Deepika. Dikshitendra stayed in Adayapalam for some time, and later on he went on a Tirthayatra to different places in Tamil Nadu. From Adayapalam, he came to the banks of Kshiranadi, and there he performed his anushthanas. He also performed, and then he moved to Pinakini Nadi, and there he performed Avagaha Snanam with Aghamarshana Mantra Japam. And then he crossed the boundaries of Tundira Mandalam or Tondai Mandalam. From there he reached Chidambaram and took darshanam of Swami Nataraja. From Chidambaram, he entered Choladesham. So Choladesham is present-day the districts of Trichy, Kumbakonam, Tanjavur and Chidambaram. So all of these places come under Choramandalam. So there he visited many kshetrams in Choladesham. After that he went to Madurai to have darshan of Meenakshi in Sundareshwara. And then he came to Trichy. So here in Trichy, he the first visited the temple of Sugandhi Kuntalamba and Matra Bhuteshwara. And then he visited Uchipillaya. And after that, he came to take darshanam of Jambukeshwara in Tiruvanaikavalar Jambukeshwara Kshetram. After that, he came to Srirangam. When he arrived at Srirangam, he was not allowed to enter into the temple of Srirangam to Sri Ranganatha. So because the Sri Vaishnavas of Srirangam did not understand him at the beginning, so they mistook him for a Vishnu Dveshi, they mistook him for someone who hated Vishnu, which he was not. Although he spoke of Shiva Paramyam, he never had hatred for Vishnu. So that is clearly evident in all of his works. So his writing of an elaborate commentary to Yadava Abhyudayama Swami Vedanta Deshikar, his writing Paduka Sahasram to Swami Vedanta, to the work Paduka Sahasram of Swami Vedanta Deshikar. So all of this stands as evidence to it. And in one of his works known as Ananda Lahari, so this is a work where he established the supremacy of Shiva. So in one of the shlokas he says, Asmakinatu Saiddhan Sikasaraniriya Yatvara Brahmakoti Shriman Narayanasan Mahita Iti Mahabharatadi Prasiddhehe. So he says that although he would speak of Shiva Paramyam or supremacy of Shiva, he would never speak anything that insults Lord Narayana. And then under the same commentary, he has written a commentary on his own work Ananda Lahari, because Dikshitendra has written commentaries to many of his own works. So that is the speciality of Dikshitendra. So rarely do we find the Granthakarta writing Sanskrit commentaries to his own text. So Dikshitendra has written many commentaries to his own works. So there under the commentary he says, Shriman Narayanasya Jiva Bhavam Vaktum Nasmat Jihva Pravartate. Because some Shaivites say that Lord Vishnu is actually a Jivatma. So Dikshitendra says that my tongue will never go on to speak in that way. Tatha cheta murdha cha shatadha bhavati. In case I go on to speak in that way, my head would burst into 100 pieces. And then he says that to do so would be Veda Vaidika droha. So it's betraying the Vedas and the Vaidika sages, Vedic sages, and Devata drohashta jayate. So it is a betrayal to all of the Devatas. So when the Sri Vaishnavas of Srirangam refused to let him enter the temple, he stood outside the temple and meditated upon the form of Ranganatha. And when the Archakas opened the Garbhagriham, to their astonishment, they could see that the Murti of Ranganatha had turned into the Murti of Parameshwara. And then the Archakas realized their mistake and they came and begged Dikshita to pardon them. Once again, when Dikshitendra entered the temple and offered praise to Sri Ranganathar, the Murti of the Lord turned from the Murti of Parameshwara back to that of Sri Ranganathar. And I'd like to say that
400 years later, you know, after this incident took place, now with his own Leela, all of the works of Dikshitendra were published here from Srirangam. So Mahatma Shri T.K. Balasubramanya Iyer. So by his, you know, his efforts, all the works of Adishankara Bhagavad Pada were published for the first time from the Vani Vilas Press of Srirangam. Most works of Dikshitendra were published from the Vani Vilas Press of Srirangam. And because of that, as Sri Sachidananda Tirtha Swamigal mentioned in his Upanyasam in 1941 here, so he says that Srirangam is Dikshitendra Grantha Bhagavad Padi Grantha Pracharasthanam and Dikshitendra Grantha Pracharasthanam. So is it not Dikshitendra's Leela that such an incident has taken place? I don't think that this is a mere coincidence. So that was the greatness of Sri T.K. Balasubramanya Iyer. So after finishing his darshanam in Srirangam, again he was invited by the Tanjavur Raja, Narasimha Bhupala Varma. So he invited Dikshitendra and another scholar who was the Asthana Pandita of Belur, Chinnaboma Raja, where Dikshitendra was also the Asthana Vidwan. So both of them had gone to the Raja's place in Tanjavur. And they had gone on, gone to visit many temples around Tanjavu. So they came to a Shasta temple in one Agraharam near Tanjavu. So Lord Ayyappan or Shasta in that temple. So the murti of that Shasta, that Lord Shasta. So he always kept his index finger on his chin. And he was, the murti of the Lord was in a very sad state. So when the Tanjavur Raja asked the residents of the village as to why the murti of the Lord was in that state, they answered that in sometime in the future, when some Mahatma comes to this temple, and when he gives the answer as to why the Lord is in such a sad state, and when the Lord is pleased with that Mahatma's answer, he will take away his tarjani or the index finger from his chin. So first, the Raja asked the other Vidwan who had been invited. So he answered that, Vishnu Sutoham Vidhinasamoham. So he says, I am the son of Lord Vishnu. And then because of that, I am equal to Lord Brahma. And because of that, all the devatas worship me. So in that way, I feel very happy. But I'm also the son of Lord Shiva. And I'm surrounded by all these bhutaganas. Because of that, I feel extremely sad. So because Shasta is the son of Parameshwara and Mohini Murti. So Mohini Devi was an avataram of Lord Vishnu. So the Lord appeared himself as Mohini Devi during the Samudra Mathanam. So when this answer was given, the Lord did not take his index finger away from his chin. When Dikshitendra was asked to answer, he says, Ambeti Gauri Mahamahvayami. So I call Gauri Devi as my mother. Patnif Pitur Matara Eva Sarvaha, because all the other, apart from his own biological mother, the other wives of a person are also considered as mothers. Pituhu Patniha, the other wives of one's father are also considered as mothers. Patnya Pitut Matara Eva Sarvaha. Kathanu Lakshmi Miti Chintayantam. But how should I call Lakshmi Devi? Because he was the son of Vishnu in the form of Mohini Devi. So how will I call Lakshmi? How will I address Lakshmi Devi? Iti Chintayantam. Shastaramide Sakalartha Siddhyai. So I worship Shasta to attain all fortunes, says Dikshitendra. And when Dikshitendra gave this answer, the murti of the Shasta took his tarjani from his chin. And all the villagers of that place felt very happy, and the Raja felt very happy. So after this, Dikshitendra went on a pilgrimage to Thiruvannamalai. So he had darshanam of Swami Annamalai.
And then he visited the temple of Apita Kuchamba. And during his visit to Devi's temple, he was struck with Shita Jwaram or hypothermia. So he prayed to Devi so that he gets his, you know, so he gets his health once again. So pleased with his prayers, Devi appeared herself and blessed him. And immediately he was cured of his Shita Jwaram. And during this time, he recited the 8 verses that came to be known as Apita Kuchamba Stavarajaha. And after this, he went back to his village of Adayapalam. During his stay in Adayapalam, the Vidwans of Kashi, so they implored him to make a visit to Kashi and bless all of them. So they also made a request to them, to him, to teach them the Shastras. So on their request, Dikshitendra made a Tirthayatra to Kashi. And there at Kashi, he performed all his Nityakarma Anushthanams. And then he also taught the Shastras to various Vidwans. Apart from all his Nityakarma Anushthanams, every day he would visit the temples of Kashi Vishveshwara, Vishalakshi, the temple of Bindu Madhavar, and the temple of Dundhirajar and Annapurna Devi. And he also observed that year Shivaratri in Kashi. And after the Shivaratri was over, the Pradosham that came immediately after Shivaratri. So during the Pradosham, he once again went to the temple of Vishveshwara to have his darshanam. And to everyone's astonishment, Vishveshwara appeared himself in person to Dikshitendra. And he told him that he was extremely pleased with his writing of Shivarkamani Deepika. And he instructed Dikshitendra to leave for Chidambaram and live and reside in Chidambaram until his last breath. And he also told that he will also get his Antyakalam. So he will get Savijya Mukti with the form of Lord Nataraja. Savijya Mukti is to merge into the form of any devata. So saying this, the Lord disappeared. Dikshitendra felt very happy. And once again, he came back from Kashi. And then after his Tirthayatra from Kashi, he was received at all honors by Chinnabomma Raja of Velur and by Shri Nrisimha Bhupala Varma of Tanjavur. So both of these kings were presented at Velur to receive Dikshitendra with all royal honors. All the Brahmanas of that place were also present. And all of them gave a royal welcome to Dikshitendra to Velur. And from Velur, Dikshitendra left for Chidambaram. And he stayed for around 10 to 12 years in Chidambaram. And it was here in Chidambaram that many interesting incidents took place. So once when Dikshitendra, he wanted to test his own bhakti on Parameshwara. So he was a Shiva Bhakta par excellence. And every day he was engaged in the puja of Shiva. Every day he was engaged in the chanting of Panchakshara Mahamantram. And he fought on the front lines of the battle of defense against Shiva Dvesham. In spite of all that, he wanted to test the genuineness of his Bhagavad Bhakti. And to do that, once he consumed the seeds and leaves of the psychedelic plant, which is known as Dhaturam. So he consumed the seeds and leaves of Dhaturam. And he instructed his disciples to note down whatever he spoke during the course of his Vishavega Avastha. And the seeds and leaves of this plant are so powerful, so toxic that a person who consumes them, he will develop acute confusion. He will develop visual and auditory hallucinations. He becomes disoriented. He gets psychosis. And then he also gets impairment of short-term memory. And he may even slip into coma. So during the, so when Dikshendra consumed the Dhatura Bijam, so the Vishavega Avastha started setting in. And when it started setting in, he began to lose his intact mentality. He started losing his awareness, then the awareness of his own material self. He started losing awareness of the operation of all his psychic processes. And what did his, the Shishyas observed during his Vishavega Avastha? So they could see, those were 50 verses in Sanskrit. And those were an outpouring of an exalted Bhagavad Bhakta. And those were an outpouring of a devotee of Lord who had completely surrendered himself unto his Upasya Devata. So there are 8 processes in Bhagavad Bhakti. Shravanam Kirtanam Vishnoho or Shambhoho, Smaranam Padasevanam, Archanam Vandanam Dasyam, Sakhyam Atmanivedanam. So Shravanam is to listen to the glories of the Lord, Shravanam Kirtanam to sing the Lord's glories, Smaranam to remember the Lord, Padasevanam to offer puja to his lotus feet, Archana, then Archanam to offer formal worship, then Vandanam, and then Dasyam is the attitude of servitude. Sakhyam is to see the Lord as one's own friend. So when all of these limbs of Bhagavad Bhakti are practiced, the heart of a Bhakta gets exercised to offer oneself completely unto his Lord. So this 9th limb of Bhakti is known as Atmanivedanam or Atmarpanam. And then the Atmarpanam, the 50 shlokas that emanated from Dikshitendra's lips got the name Atmarpana Stuti or Unmatta Panchashata. So the word Atmarpana Stuti means Atmanaha Arpanam. Atmanaha means of one's own self. Arpanam is to offer it to the Lord. Atmarpanena Rachita Stutihi Atmarpana Stutihi. So a stuti that is composed by offering one's own self to the Lord, it is known as Unmatta Panchashata, because Unmatta Avasthayam Rachitaha Panchashat Shlokanam Samaharaha. So a collection of 50 verses that have been written in a state where the sensorium and cognition have ceased to function. So, during his lifetime, Dikshitendra consumed poison thrice. So once in Velur, he was offered Tirtha Prasadam in Varadaraja Swami temple. So when he consumed the Tirtha Prasadam, which was mixed with poison, nothing happened to him. And once in the court of Chinnabhama Raja, so when Vakyartha Vidvat Sabha was going on, and there was a discussion on the meaning of the word Neelakantha. And during the course of the Vakyartham, Dikshitendra quoted a shloka from Srimad Bhagavatam. So from the chapter of Samudra Mathanam, so there is a shloka which says, Tadugravegam Dishidishyaparyadho Visarpadut Sarpada Zahya Viryam. So when he, when the mountain was being churned, so the very first entity that emerged from the Samudram was the Kalakuta Visham. And when the Visham appeared, so all the Devas and Asuras, so all of them along with Bhagavan Vishnu became scared, and all of them took shelter under Lord Shiva. And it was then when everybody made Sharanagati under him, Lord Shiva consumed the Kalakuta Visham. So when Dikshitendra explained the supremacy of Lord Shiva by quoting this shloka, and he gave a detailed explanation of this shloka. And one scholar in the Sabha, so he asked Dikshitendra if it is true that Parameshwara is the Supreme Lord, is it possible for Shivopasaka like you to consume poison and remain unharmed? Is it possible for you to remain unharmed even after consuming a poison? And Dikshitendra said, yes, it is possible for me to remain unharmed even if I consume a poison. And that Vidwan ordered his men to get a lethal poison. And Dikshitendra was ready to consume that poison orally. And the Raja dissuaded him to consume it. So the Dikshitendra assured him that nothing would happen to him. And he consumed the poison. And true to his words, nothing happened to Dikshitendra. And everyone was astonished at this leela that took place. And it was at this time that Dikshitendra wrote stotrams like Shiva Mahima Kalika Stuti and others. But Mahima Kalika Stuti is a very beautiful stotram, and this is a very rare piece in the whole of stotram literature. So all of our acharyas have written many, all the stotrams which all of our acharyas have written. So they have, they are steeped in the doctrine of Vedanta. The stotrams of Adi Shankara Bhagavatpada, the stotrams of Jagadguru Shankaracharya, Shri Sachidananda Shivabhinam, Nrisimha Bharati Swamigal, and the stotrams of all other Advaita saints. So all of these are rooted in Advaita Siddhantam. Similarly, the stotrams of Ramanujacharya, Shri Swami Vedanta Deshikar, and others are rooted in Vishishtadvaita Vedantam. The stotrams of many Madhva saints are rooted in the Madhva Siddhantam, in Dvaita Vedantam. But very few saints and acharyas have written, have integrated Purvamimamsa Shastram and Bhagavad Bhakti. So Dikshitendra has made such an integration. So he has integrated Purvamimamsa Nyayams, and he has interwoven those Nyayams along with Shiva Bhakti, and then he has composed the beautiful stotram known as Shiva Mahima Kalika Stuti. And then during his residence in Chidambaram Kshetram, many leelas have taken place. So once there was a yoga mandapam in which he used to regularly visit. So there is a very old yoga mandapam, and he used to sit there, and then he used to enter into the state of samadhi. And once when he entered into the samadhyavastha sitting in that yoga mandapam, and when he came back from antarmukhavastha to bahirmukhavastha, so when he came out from the state of deep trance, all his sons, grandsons and disciples, so when all of them saw him, a very interesting thing took place. So there was a very bright effulgence from the face of Dikshitendra. A plentiful effulgence emanated from his face. On seeing his face, the tejas that emanated from his face, some of them got scared. They were terrified with fear. And they were standing as if they were all, they became immobile. And some of them who were, psychologically strong, they were able to offer namaskarams to him. And some of them could see the form of Nataraja Murti in Dikshitendra. So they could see Nataraja seated along with Patanjali Maharshi. So in this way, Dikshitendra instructed all of his shishyas. And after instructing them, he took his original form from that form. And when he took back this form, all of them who were scared of seeing his, the original form, they all became, they all came out of their fear. And once when Dikshitendra was doing, offering Shiva Puja, his Dharmapatri wanted to see what he was doing, because every time when Dikshitendra performs puja, sometimes he would close the door, and he would not permit anyone to be present in the puja graham, and he would not permit anyone to see what is going on inside. During one such time, his wife wanted to see what was going on inside. And when she peeped through a small hole that was there inside the door, she saw the original form of Dikshitendra, and she fainted out of fear. And apart from this, two great personalities came to meet Dikshitendra during his residence in Chidambaram. One was a sannyasi from Maharashtra. He was known as Nrisimha Bharati Swami and Nrisimhashrama Swamigal. The other one was the celebrated Sri Bhattoji Dikshitar. When the Vidwans in the whole of India heard the glories of Dikshitendra as a scholar in many different shastras, when they heard of his glories as a scholar of par excellence in Shivadvaita Vedantam, one sannyasi from Maharashtra felt very bad. So he came all the way from Maharashtra seeking Dikshitendra, who was living in a distant land. And he came to a when he was about to reach Chidambaram, he visited an agraharam near Chidambaram. And the people there did not offer diksha to Dikshitendra, not to Nrisimhashrama Swamigal. And the sannyasi just went away. And the sin of offending a sannyasi burnt the whole of that village. And after that, the sannyasi came towards Chidambaram. And when he entered Chidambaram, Dikshitendra received the sannyasi in Nrisimhashrama Swamigal. He received the Nrisimhashrama Swamigal with all honors, with all the, you know. And then he offered bhiksha to him at his home. And while having discussions, you know, the sannyasi expressed a desire to Dikshitendra. He said, for so many years you have been engaging in battles for the defense against Shivadvesham. So you have worked so much for Shivadvaita Vedantam, but you have not turned your attention towards the Matam of Adi Shankara Bhagavatpada. You have taken birth in the family of Advaita, the great Advaita Vidyacharyas, but you have not made great contributions to the Matam of Bhagavatpada. So you studied Advaita, Vedantam under your father in your earlier years. So it would be great if you turn your attention towards Advaita Vedantam. Even today, many scholars find it very difficult to study and comprehend commentary like Vedanta Kalpataru of Swami Amalananda. So a person like you should comment or write a commentary upon Vedanta Kalpataru and bless the Panditas. So when Dikshitendra heard the words of Swamigal, so it was after this that he wrote the celebrated commentaries Nyaya Rakshamani and Kalpataru Parimalam. And Dikshitendra says that in his commentary, Parimalam. No, the very first shloka of Parimalam goes on like this. Guru Bhirupadishtamartham Vismritam apitatra bodhitam prajnyaihi avalambhya shivamadhiyanna yathamati vyakaromi kalpataram tudyarmi refers to. And he explains that in his own commentary in Parimalam towards the end of chapter 1 and Padam 1. So Guru Bhir Upadishtam Artham. Upadishtam means anything that has been instructed. And then Vismritam api, he forgot the, to exert efforts in Advaita Vedantam for many years in his life. So Vismritam api, tatra bodhitam prajnyaihi. Then he says, I was reminded once again by Prajnyaha, great men. And the word Prajna refers to Sri Nrisimhashrama Swamigal here. Tatra bodhitam prajnaihi. And then avalambhya shivam adhiyanna. And then yathamati vyakaromi kalpataru. So again he says, by studying studying and teaching Shivadvaita Vedantam, shivam adhiyanna yathamati. According to my own intellect, I will write a commentary upon Kalpataru. So it's because of the grace of Nrisimhashrama Swamigal that we have been blessed with commentaries like Kalpataru, Parimalam and Nyaya Rakshamani. So the celebrated Vyakarana Vidwan, Sri Bhattoji Dikshitar, who wrote works like Siddhanta Kaumudi. So he came on a Tirthayatra to Rameshwaram. During his Tirthayatra to Rameshwaram, so he heard of the glories of Dikshitendra and he wanted to see Dikshitendra and study Purva Mimamsa and Vedantam from him. So when he went to the house of Dikshitendra and Chidambaram, he was sitting outside his house, our Vasa Tindala Okandranda. Okandra, he was teaching the work of Bhattoji Dikshitar, Siddhanta Kaumudi. And when teaching, the text Siddhanta Kaumudi to his disciples, he told that at one place in Siddhanta Kaumudi, the author of Siddhanta Kaumudi has expressed views that are not in line with the views of Bhashyakara. And in such and such place, the author deviates from the views of Bhashyakara. And when Bhattoji Dikshitar heard these words from Dikshitendra,
he answered samadhanam to Dikshitendra and saying that the author did not write them in with that intention, and this is the original intention of the author. And when Dikshitendra was hearing the samadhanam of Bhattoji Dikshita, he asked him, now is this work a brainchild of yours? Are you Bhattoji himself? When Dikshitendra asked this question to him, he felt extremely happy. And he said, yes, I am Bhattoji Dikshita. And he offered Sashtanga Namaskaram to Dikshitendra. And then he expressed his desire to study Purva Mimamsa and Vedantam under the lotus feet of Dikshitendra. And with Dikshitendra's, when Dikshitendra accepted it, he then went on to his pilgrimage to Rameshwaram. And then when he returned from Rameshwaram, he came back to the house of Dikshitendra and studied Purva Mimamsa and Advaita Vedantam. And it is as per Dikshitendra's instructions that he wrote a Vedantic text like Tattva Kaustubham. So that is the greatness of Dikshitendra. And then during his last days, he was not well for a few weeks or a few days. He was unwell for some time. And he was, during the last days, when his sons and the sons and grandsons and all his disciples asked him what he would desire for, he answered them that his only desire is to see Natarajar and take his darshanam. And once again, he went into at home, when he was having discussions with his sons and disciples, once again, he went into a state of samadhi. And when he came back from samadhi, his disciples asked him what he experienced in that state. And he explained the bliss of Supreme Advaya Brahman. So the state of Turiya Shiva is what he experienced. So it was the Advaitic bliss that he experienced. And in spite of experience, the bliss of Advaita, he told them that he still had a longing desire to see the murti of Nataraja. And so all of his sons took him to the temple of Nataraja. And there, at the sannidhi of Nataraja, he spoke 1.5 shlokas with great devotion. And these are those two shlokas. Chidambaramidam puram prathitameva punyasthalam sutashta vinayojvala sukritayashchakashchitkritaha vayamsi mama saptate rupari naiva bhoge spriha nakinkidahamarthaye shivapadam didrukshayaparam abhatihatakasabha natapadapatma jyotikmayo manasime tarunarunoyam. So these are this is the 1.5 shloka which Dikshitendra spoke. Chidambaram idam puram prathitameva punyasthalam. So this holy town of place of Chidambaram is a very famous place of pilgrimage. Prathitameva punyasthalam sutashta vinayojvalaha. So I have been blessed with sons who are extremely humble. Sukritayashchakashchitkritaha. I have also performed some sukritis in life. Sukritayashchakashchitkritaha. Vayamsi mama saptate rupari. So I have crossed 70 years of age. Naiva bhoge spriha. So I don't feel like enjoying anything and any material comforts in life. Naiva bhoge spriha. Nakinchi dahamarthaye. I don't yearn for anything. I don't desire for anything. Shivapadam didrikshaya param. I only yearn to see the supreme abode of Parameshwara. Shivapadam didrikshaya param. And then he says, abhati hataka sabhana tapadapatma jyotirmayo manasime tarunarunoyam. Abhati means to shine brightly. Hataka sabhana tapadapatma jyotirmayaha. The supreme light, jyotirmayaha. Again, tarunarunaha is something that resembles the early mornings in tarunarunaha. I am tarunarunaha. So the supreme light of Lord Natarajar's Padapadmam, the lotus feet of Natarajar, Hataka Sabha. Hataka means gold. Hataka Sabha is Kanaka Sabha. So Lord Nataraja is situated in the Kanaka Sabha. Abhati Hataka Sabha Natapada Patmat Jyotirmayaha Manasime Taruna Arunoyam. And saying the first two quarters of the second shloka, saying this, he started ascending on the steps that lead to the Garbhagriham of Nataraja. And when he started entering into it, so what happened was, a very bright radiance emanated from the Murti of Nataraja, from the Garbhagriham. And Vishitendra's Murti started getting absorbed into the effulgence that emanated. And the effulgence started growing big. And eventually it started growing small and then receded back into the Murti of Nataraja. And K.V. Subramanya Shastrikal says in his Dikshitendra Vijayam, it is Ardha Shlokam Abhidhaya Sadhya Eva Sarasvatya Lingita Brahmarandhraha. So when Dikshitendra finished the first two quarters of second shloka, so immediately his Brahmarandhram or the Sahasrara Chakram broke open. And Saraswati here means Sushumna Nadi, the word. There are three nadis in the body, Ida, Pingala and Sushumna. So the Sushumna Nadi is also known as Saraswati Nadi. So when the Saraswati Nadi touches the Brahmarandram, so they've got sutures in the skull, no membranous gaps between the different bones of the skull. So when the Sushumna Nadi touches them, when the Sushumna Nadi gets activated, the Brahmarandram, the suture, the sutures of the skull break open. When the Brahmarandram breaks, at the Yogi Purusha, he gets mukti. And it has to be remembered that the Dikshitendra was also a great Yogi Purusha. He was also a Yogindra. He was not just a Nityagni Hotri. He was not a mere Mahavratayaji. He was not a mere Shabdika Pravara or a great scholar in Vyakarana Shastra. He was not a mere Mimamsaka Murdhanya. He was not just the topmost among Mimamsa scholars. He was not just a scholar of our excellence in Shivadvaita Vedanta. He was not just a scholar of our excellence in Advaita Vedanta. He was not a mere he was not just an extraordinary scholar of Sanskrita Sahityam. He was also a very great Yogi Purusha. Again, Shivananda Yogindra gives a detailed description of Dikshitendra performing Yoga Anushthanam. And through the process of Ashtanga Yoga, he worships Swami Natarajar in Chidambaram. So Dikshitendra was also an Ashtanga Yoga Anushthana Nishtha. So Sadhya Eva Sarasvatya Lingita Brahmarandhaha Tamasamaya Sangata Saptabalaha Kasaudamini Punjasani Prabhabha Swaraste Mahanubhavaha. So when the brilliant radiance appeared from the Garbhagriham, and then says K.V. Subramanya Shastrigal, Swasamaradhitasya Devata Sarvabhaumasya Chandrachudamanehe Natarajasya Parasmin Jyotishi Vililire. So Dikshitendra merged into the supreme light of Lord Nataraja, and this kind of mukti is known as Sayujya Mukti. So there are different types of mukti: Sayujya Mukti, Samipya Mukti, Salokya Mukti, Sarshti Mukti, and then there is the Nirvikalpa kind of mukti, Kaivalyam. So among these, Sayujya Mukti, Shri Jagadguru Shankaracharya, Shri Sachidananda Swabhin, Nrisimha Bharati Swamigal explains the term Sayujyam in a Vedanta grantham written by him, which is known as Purushartha Nirnayaha. So there he says, Sayujyam Nama Sagudasya Devata Rupasya Ahangrahopasanam Kurvataha Upasya Devata Tadatyam, says Acharya. The word Sayujyam means Sagunasya. So the form of Devata, which is also an aspect of, which is an aspect of Saguna Brahman. Then a devotee who performs Ahangrahopasana. So the Ahangrahopasana is something, it's a kind of Vedantic Upasana, wherein the Upasaka meditates upon the Sagunam aspect of the Supreme Lord, who is situated between the chambers of the heart, which is known as Hridayakasham. So And then Upasya Devata Tadatmyam, Upasakasya Upasya Devata Tadatmyam. Upasya Devata is the deity that is being worshipped. Upasya Tadatmyam is to attain the status of oneness with the deity of the Lord whom the devotee worships. So this is what Acharya says in his Purushartha Nirnaya. And K.V.S. Brahmanya Shastrikal says that this incident took place on the in the early hours of the morning of Chaitra Purnima day. And then he says, Harahara Mahadeveti Pashyatam Bhakta Jananam Samaksham. And then he says, all the devotees were chanting Bhagavad Gosham saying, Harahara Mahadeva. It was at that time that this incident took place, the Sahaja Prapti or Dikshitendra Niryanam, or Niryanam means disappearance from the earthly planet. So the Dikshitendra Niryanam or Dikshitendra Sahaja Prapti took place in the morning of Chaitra Purnima day. Tadani, tat tejas patala madhye vibhasamanam Dikshitendra Murtim Pashyantaha Archakada Archaka Dikshitadayaha Shambhava Gresaraha Paramashcharya Bharitaha. So at that time, when the Tillai Dikshitars and others looked at the murti of Dikshitendra, which was seen within the bright effulgence that emanated, all of them were awestruck. Paramashcharya Bharitaha. Vitihotra Hutapratikasya Samprapta Brahmanatanoho Bhagavati Kanakasabha Pralinasya Bhatta Chudamane hai Anandanasyanantaram Dikshitendranam eva samvrittam tadrisham aiki bhavam prakhyapayamasuhu. Bhiti hotra huta pratikasya. So there is a very famous, Nayanmar, a great devotee of Lord Shiva in Tamil Nadu. So he was known as Nandana Nayanar. So because he was born in a community of Chandalas, he was not allowed inside the temple in those days. So he would often do pradakshinam outside the kshetram of Chidambaram, and then he used to worship the Lord. Pleased with his devotion, the Lord instructed Nandideva to move a little aside so that this great devotee could have darshan of him by standing outside the temple, so that Nandideva moved from his position. And one day, when the Lord was extremely pleased with his devotion, he appeared in the dream of this devotee, Nandana, and he asked him to come to the temple, come outside the presence of the temple the next day, and a great agni would be, homam would be performed. And when he enters into the agni, he could then enter into the temple. He also appeared in the dream of all the Tillai Dikshitars. And the next day morning, all the Tillai Dikshitars came with Purna Kumbham. And the agni was also prepared, the homam was also prepared. And when Nandanar entered into the agni, he got purified, and when he came out, he emerged as a brahmana with yajnopavitam and shikha, and with Purna Kumbham, and the Tillai Dikshitars took him at, invited and took him inside the temple. And when he reached the sannidhi of Nataraja, He merged into the murti of Nataraja. He attained oneness with the murti of Nataraja. So again, he says, K.V.S. Brahmanya Shastrikal says, Nandanakhyasya bhakta chudamane hai anantaram Dikshitendranameva. After the time of Nandana Nayana, so such an incident occurred only to Srimad Appaya Dikshitendra. And prakshapayamasuhu. So the Tillai Dikshitars spread the word of this incident to all the people around. And then after this incident took place, so the eldest son of Dikshitendra, who was named as Neelakantha Dikshita, so this Neelakantha Dikshita should not be confused with the Neelakantha Dikshita of Palamade. That Neelakantha Dikshita was the grandson of Dikshitendra's younger brother Achan Dikshita. And this Neelakantha Dikshita was the eldest son of Dikshitendra. Dikshitendra had 5 children. The first 3 were sons. The eldest was Neelakantha Dikshita. The second son was Umamaheshwara Dikshita. The third son was Chandravatamsa Dikshita. The fourth daughter was Markatavalli. And the fifth daughter was
Mangalambika. And the eldest son of Dikshitendra, Neelakantha Dikshita, he subjoined Dikshitendra and he finished the remaining two quarters of the second shloka. And he said, Nunam Jaramarana Ghora Pishacha Kirna Samsara Moharajini Diratim Prayata. So because Dikshitendra was no more when the first two quarters of the second shloka were recited, after that he was no more. And then his sons have joined him to finish the second half of it. And so this is the Nunam, certainly. Jaramanada Ghoran Pshacha Gheer, the Samsara Moharajani, the bewilderment of the night of material existence, which is infested with many monsters in the form of repeated births and deaths, has come to an end. Samsara Moharajani, Viratim Prayata has come to an end. So after this, Yathashrautam Sarvamapi Ardhvakarma Parisamapayama K.V. Subramanya Shastri. After this incident took place, all his sons performed the Antya Samskaran for Dikshitendra as per the Shrauta Vidhanam. So because when Grihastha Brahmana dies, so all the Vedic rites that take place will take place according to the Smartha Karmas. So because when a person who has taken up Agnihotra Adhanam and has performed many Shrauta Yajnams, so when such a person dies, so there are a lot of other procedures also involved. So apart from the Smartha Vidhanams, many Shrauta Vidhanams will also take place when an Ahitagni dies. So an Agnihotri worships three Agnis every day. Garhapati Agni, Dakshinagni, and Ahavani Agni. So all of these three Agnis are made into one. And this Agni will be taken to the Shmashanam, and with that, the Ahita Agni's Shariram is burnt. And then the eldest son of the Ahita Agni will rub the two eyes of him, rub the two eyes and his Hridayam. And the two palms of his father, along with plates made of gold. So all of the after these. So when the shariram of, so this is how all of these the karmas take place. So yathashrautam. So because Dikshitendra's shariram was not available. So because he attained Sayuja Prapti, because he merged into the deity of Nataraja. So only a Dharma Samskaram could be performed. Only a Dharma Samskaram must have been performed by his son Neelakantha Dikshita and others. And after this bitter glow, the bittersweet event of Dikshitendra's Dhyanam took place. So all of them were also, they missed Dikshitendra. And they also felt very happy at the Divyam sight that took place. And with this, I conclude today's lecture, and I would like to finish it with the Mangalacharanam of the Dikshitendra Navaratna Malika of Sri Mannargudi Raju Shastri. And before that, I would like to just remind of one more thing. And the Sutta Samhita says that a very high, very exalted devotee of the Lord, during his last times, the Lord blesses him by showing his cosmic dance to the devotee. It says Sutta Samhita is a part of Skanda Purana. So it says, Pradarshayannateshvara Samasta Deva Sannidhau Swadarshanam Swadarshanam Vimuktidam Mahattaram Maheshvaraha Samasta Loka Rakshakam Mahatmanam Hrudishthitam. So the word Pradarshayannateshvaraha, Nateshwarha, Lord Nataraja Pradarshan, he shows his dance. And then Swanartanam, his own dance. Then Muktidam is something that gives Mukti to a devotee. Mahattaram, something that is great. Maheshwaraha, Samasta Loka Rakshakam. So this cosmic dance protects all of the, protects all the Samasta Loka Rakshakam, Mahatmanam Hridishthitam, and great Mahatma's contemplate on that cosmic Natanam of the Lord. And so it says, Mahatma Nam Hridu, Nirikshanarhamishwaro Karotsabhapatishivaha, Nirikshanarhamishwara, Nirikshanarham. So all those devotees who yearn to see that So Ishvara, so the Lord shows that supreme dance to the devotees in his sannidhi at Chidambaram in the presence of all the devatas. So with this, I conclude today's bhashanam. And with this, I finish it with Dikshitendranavaratnamalika of Mahamahopadhyaya Nityagnihotri, Shri Vannargudi Rajashastrigal.
Asmallokavatam sadhvarivara rachitaha ye prabandhah prathante deshe deshe vidushmatyati mushita brihanmoha sandoha vrindaha teshamattham yathavat katichana kritina sarvatantrai gavedyam धन्याः संविद्रते तान् शरणयतु जनो घोर संसार भीरुः मूर्धन्यत्वेन मीमांसकवरनिकरे ये स्तुताः कौस्तुभेऽपि श्रीमन्तो यत्प्रबन्धाः शतमिह विदुषां वृन्दमानन्दयन्ति अन्यानाघ्रातयुक्तिप्रचयघटनया संसितं वत्वतन्त्रम् नानोदाहारयुक्ताः त्रिविधविधिभिदाय स्फुटं ज्ञापितानः आत्मज्ञानं विमुक्तेः गमकमिति तदभ्यर्थिनां सद्यथीनां तद्यो मुक्तेरवाप्त्यै यरसि परिमलोऽन्याय रक्षामणिश्च सार्वज्ञं वीक्ष्य येषां प्रथितकविवरैः सार्वभौमैश्च शंसे येषामाशीर्गिराभूत् अखिलकुशलभाङ्मीलकण्ठाध्वरीन्द्रः येषां तादात्विकेभ्यः किल सकलकलावल्लभत्वं बुधेभ्यः सर्वेभ्योऽभ्यर्हितं द्रात् अभवदिति समाकर्तये वर्तये किं माध्वे तन्त्रेऽपि तिष्ठन् मधुमथन सदाराधनोद्धूतपुण्यैः शुद्धात्मा श्रद्धाधीतश्रुतिं वकुटगते ब्रह्मणि स्वात्मभूते इत्यालोच्य स्वयं तद्विहितमपि मतं रक्षितुं ग्रन्थभेदे माध्वानाय्यै प्रणीतं परमहितकरी न्यायमुक्तावलीसा येषां पादाब्जरेणुस्मरणमलमघौघस्य विध्वस्तये नः पुञ्जौघस्योपचित्यै न तदुभयजुषां किञ्चिदन्यथ्यपेक्ष्यम् प्रायो लोकोपकारप्रवणितमनसस्वान्वये जन्मभाजम् ते मां रक्षन्तु भीतं भवदवदहनात् सम्प्रसाद्याम्बिकेशं यत्क्रोचे शम्भुभक्तिं विघटयितुमलं तद्वमुक्ता कलापे प्रत्यूचे तच्छ्रुतीनां दययुथ विवृते शैव कर्तामृतादौ श्रीकण्ठार्जोक्तिमूलं परमतमपि तन्मूलितं तत्र भावात् कोऽन्यशक्तो भविष्यात् मखिकुलतिलकात् सर्वलोकोपकृत्यै प्रबन्धशतनिर्मितिः प्रथितमग्निहोत्रादिकं श्रुतप्रवचनादयश्रितजनावनार्थं प्रभोः सभां प्रति गतागतं समुदितं महीन्द्रेषु नः कियत्कलसता सतामपि ततः परेषां भुवि शङ्कर भगवत्पादाचार्यास्त्वद्वैतमार्गमिव ये प्रत्यतिष्ठिपन् भुवि शिवभक्तिपथं कथं न ते वन्द्याः नवरत्नमालिकैषा मखिराजचरित्रमञ्जुमञ्जूषा दुरितौ गतिमिरपूषा जोषार्धतनोस्तनोतु परितोषम् श्रीमदप्पय्य दीक्षितेन्द्र परब्रह्मणे नमः हर नमः पार्वती पतये हर हर महादेव
शिवाय गुरवे नमः सद्गुरु चरणारविन्दाभ्यां नमः Nothing is a coincidence in this life for us. With the blessings of our Jagatgurus and the grace of Sharadamba, we were able to celebrate the 500th Jayanti of Appaya Dikshitendra, an Avatara Purusha, with his Vijayam from the Jananam to his Brahma Sayujyam from this Ghora Samsara Biruhu. So without the blessings, nothing happens. From straight from Sri Rangam, he spoke so much about Apaidikshitendra, his Purvacharyas, and his grandfather, Vakshasthala Acharya, Rangaraja Advari, and then Apaidikshitendra, getting the Brahma Sayujyam through the observance of Pravruddhi Marga and leading ultimately to the Shiva Paramyam, amazingly expounded by this young Brahmachari, Dr. Gokulakrishna Iyer. We pray to Goddess Shardamba and our Adi Shankar Guru Parampara to bestow all their blessings, rather choices, blessings, for all that he desires in his life in propagating this Advaita Siddhanta, and especially the Apaya Dikshitendra, his works, his life. So with that wishes and prayers, we give our thanks to Dr. Gokulakrishna Iyer for his beautiful talks, three-part series. And we thank you so much, Dr. Gokulakrishna Iyer. And coming back to the blessings of our acharyas, Sri Sannidhanam chose the three important stutis of Apaidikshitendra. It is not without a coincidence. We have known about Devi Chandrakala Stuti, Aditya Stotra Ratnam, and Margabandhu Stotram. These are comparatively easier slokas for us to learn and do the Parayanam. Yet, when Sannidhanam has chosen these three, obviously, there has to be some mumukshu out there who has to get this message and the whatever, you know, elevation that they are aspiring for. So let us be also be part of this samskara in doing this Parayanam and getting there sooner rather than later with the Shraddha that is required. We have heard Shastrasya Guru Vakyasya Satya Buddhi Avadharana Sa Shraddha Khatita Sadvihi. So we definitely have that, and we have seen the examples from Adi Shankara himself, from the, you know, Nivritti Marga, and our acharyas observing that, greater sannyasins and tapasvins that 1200 years of history has produced, and many more of our births, I mean, hope not. So they'll be there to give us that and take us, handhold us and get us there without doubt, without a doubt. And Apaidikshitendra himself as a grihastha doing this. And thank you so much to all of you. And please do the Parayanam. And we are very happy to release this three important stutis rendered in the voice of Gokulakrishna Iyer and beautifully compiled together in a video form by our own Swaminathan. We are releasing this to the public, which means that with the blessings of Acharya, this is made available to public for our Nitya Parayanam. Let us make use of it and get the elevation that is required of us to get there. The anugraham is very important, but the Shraddha has to be there. So unless, you know, we get out of the comfort zone, nothing is possible. So let us learn to get out of the comfort zone to get there. Thank you so much. And we thank Tattvaloka also, Tattvaloka, for being part of this initiative. And we are having many more Parayanams coming up for Navaratri and for Jnananda Bharti Swamiji's Jayanti. And our Guru Seva continues with this. Please enjoy the three Stotra Parayanam that is available for public. Please let all your friends and relatives know. Thank you so much.
I'd like to thank once again the organizers of this event, the Tattvaloka team and Sringeri Guru Bandhava team and all the viewers. And once again, I offer my Sashtanga Namaskaram at the lotus feet of Jagat Guru Shankaracharyas of Sringeri, Paramahamsa Parivrajakacharya Shri Bharati Tirtha Mahaswamigal, Paramahamsa Parivrajakacharya Shri Vidushekara Bharati Swamigal. So thanks a lot. And Dhinatrayam Evedam, Sudhinatrayam Samajani. Yeah.
Thank you so much, Gokul. Sadguru Sharanaravindabhyam Namaha.